Welcome to Adam Does Movies Live. I got John with me co-hosting on this.
Hello. Hello. I'm really excited to try this feature out. We are live streaming to two separate YouTube channels right now.
Are you on Jogwheel or MovieNight? Which one are you?
Jogwheel, because that has 700,000 more people on it.
Oh, okay.
not that any of those people will be watching, but law of averages, it'll probably get a few more.
Yeah, you might wake someone up from the dark depths of YouTube subscribers, and they're like, John Paula, why does that name sound so familiar?
That's a name I've not heard in a long time.
Comes out of the cave. John Paula. Yeah, if you don't remember, you know what? I was thinking more like Marshall Mathers, Eminem, Slim Shady. Yeah, yeah. But yeah. Either way is fine. If you don't remember, John, he was on my channel, last year? I think you did a live stream with me. Maybe two. It's been a while.
No. We talked about our favorite movies, and that was only like 4 months ago, I think.
It was like, to me, that's like 8 years ago.
I mean, admittedly, that technically is last year, but I think it was somewhat recently. Was it within this school, within the school year, I think.
Okay. So. Well, since that time, you've come back into the fold. Not like, you know, I mean, you're officially back, like John Wick.
That's right. And I don't know if you saw my first video, but I spoofed that exact scene from that movie. I'm thinking I'm back. I did that exact bit. I had to. I'm like, there's a lot of different ways I can play this, but...
Does it bother you that in that scene of that epic movie, when he says that iconic line, "Yeah, I'm thinking I'm back," he immediately gets his ass kicked right afterwards? I was expecting him to be like, boom, double guns, and just take everyone out.
It is very telling that he says it from a position of weakness, which I think is why the line is so cool, because he's like literally tied and bound and gagged. And he's like, "Yeah, what are you going to do?" It's like, anything I want, because you're my captive right now.
Yeah.
And the other guy, the Russian, he walks away. Like, John's just saying this iconic line to, like, an empty chair.
to the camera guy. Do we get that?
Yeah. He's like, "I don't care. Do what you want with him." And then he walks away and leaves. And John's like, "I'm taking him back." To who? Who? He walked away. You don't kill him until the end of the movie.
Right. It was a little weirdly timed, but though. still awesome and a great line to quote. But anyway, yeah, John's doing it at least once a month. He's putting out a big movie. He did the Dune, all the movies, right?
And the
TV show.
And the documentary about the Dune movie that wasn't, which I didn't even know existed until a couple weeks ago. And I was Wikipediaing furiously trying to keep up with what was going on in David Lynch's Dune. And then I learned this was the first adaptation. But the second attempted, and I'm like, "What do you mean? Right. There was an earlier one?" And yeah, this Chilean French filmmaker by the name of Alejandro Jodorowsky attempted it in 1975, and he just he got all this money and he made all these storyboards and no one would finance his like 8-hour idea, and I was like, "You're out of your mind, buddy."
It's hard to perfect the spice. It really is.
Yes.
It's also hard to perfect an Oscar, but we are going to be talking about that on today's live stream. It's Tuesday. I go live every Tuesday. It's a fun time typically. And I'm already reminded that there are two super chats shot out of a cannon. Hack the movies for $2, says this super chat is shot out of a cannon. Okay, that's the expression I use. Thank you, Hack the Movies. Tony's actually sad, John. I bumped him from this episode today. He wanted to come on. He's like, hey, Adam, I'll do the live. I'm like, I got Paula coming on, Tony. You're going to have to wait. You have to get
too,
in line.
It's too late. You missed your shot, Tony. Sorry.
You missed your shot, T-Bone.
Is there, do you have a one guest at a time rule, though? Because, I mean,
no,
I'm...
No.
Okay.
No.
Well, next time, let's make it a three-way.
But Tony, I think, knows less about the Oscars than I do, admittedly.
That's fair.
And I know
And you know less than I do.
What?
I think you
admitted... Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. I wanted you on this because you kind of... It's a Super Bowl for you still. It used to be for me a decade back, but I really fell off.
You should, I'll try to make the case over the next 90 minutes or
Please
whatever.
Please do, yeah.
That they're worth coming back to. They had a bit of a resurgence in relevance and I think accuracy, for lack of a better word. I feel like the last five or six winners have been like, yeah, I can get on board with that. That's a movie I legitimately liked. Whereas we're going to get into some movies that were both like, how did this beat Inception lost to this?
Right.
So, but I feel like the last few years is like, yeah, that's, I like that as a winner. And they've been, and a big reason for that is, I want to say in 2019 or 20, they switched to preferential voting, like a ranked system. So all the Academy members are allowed to rank what they want to win. And that has resulted in less just like runaway upsets that don't make any sense. And we're getting more like, oh, this is a consensus that everyone might not have put as their favorite, but everyone liked second best. And like, that's better than some weird pick getting the trophy at the end of the
night. Right. Well, yeah, I did look at the winners this year and I was actually thinking, yeah, these are all pretty fair, almost boring. They're so accurate.
I like it when the ceremony is predictable because that means they're getting the picks correct.
They're doing it correctly. Yeah.
I like that.
James D became a YouTube member. Thank you, James. Just want to remind folks that Super Chats are the name of the game. Basically, the lifeblood of this channel was last year. It continues probably to be so. Also, Patreon. Patreon.com/AdamDoesMovies. I'm doing vlogs every week over there. So if you're at the $10 tier, you get a vlog. And it's not just some crap-ass, half-ass thing. I mean, I'm putting in some production work. They're really good. So maybe think about becoming at least a gold member. And then the higher your tier level, obviously, the better. One more, and we're going to jump into the actual conversation. We got one from Perm for $5 out of a cannon, Perm. Who will direct the upcoming movie about the coronavirus? Quentin Tarantino? Oh, he said, I'm sorry, Quentin Quarantino. He wanted just that joke. It was all for the joke.
There's actually a great meme account on Instagram called Quentin Quarantino. and it is a fun follow. Although you joke, but we got the Corona movie already. It was called Quarantine, right? No, not Quarantine.
Oh, that's right.
Outbreak. It came out like 12 years ago with Gwyneth Paltrow in it, and was it Danny Boyle directed that one? And it's good. It's a pretty good movie.
It's pretty good. It's Contagion.
Contagion, that's it.
It's funny that you say Gwyneth Paltrow stars in it, though, because Gwyneth Paltrow stars in it about as much as Steven Seagal stars in, what was that movie?
Executive Decision.
Executive Decision. they're both killed off within the first 3 minutes.
Well, yeah, Patient Zero, right? She's the first one to die. She's the first white person to die, because that's in the framework of the story. That's all we care about. It's good. And if you haven't seen it, I would go back, check it out, because having watched it post-COVID...
Yeah.
It's very upsetting.
It's
like
hauntingly
how much it got right. Yeah,
it's
right.
Hauntingly accurate. Yeah,
it got a lot of things right in the worst way, and it's like we didn't heed any of these warnings.
Outbreak's better for the spectacle and the blockbustery look, but Contagion's better as just this is real raw stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so John and I talked off cam. We wanted to do something fun for the Oscars, and we didn't want to just do a recap of Dunkachino forgetting to list off the nominations, or you know, Ken dancing up on the stage. And there was plenty of great highlights, but I'm pretty sure everyone's already seen them on Instagram or on TikTok. We can definitely kind of like joke about them here and there, but we thought it would be fun to do a little bit of a history lesson and take four different categories, pick some of our favorites from said categories, and at the end of this, let you guys at least vote or argue in the comments about who you think had the better picks. So the four categories we have are biggest Oscar snubs. And this is ranging, you know, 50 or so odd years.
I think we'll just do last 50 years. So Godfather 2 until today. And I think that is easier because I think we're both less familiar with the stuff from 30s, 40s, and 50s. I've seen all of those winners, but I don't know enough about their competition to say this didn't deserve to win.
Yeah, that's absolutely reasonable and accurate to what we did. But we have biggest snub, we have worst Oscar moments, we have favorite Oscar moments, and then we have worst Best Picture winner. It's quite a...
Or maybe biggest upset would be another way to categorize that last one.
Biggest upset's probably... Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. I mean, the
it's more clickbait.
The naming of the category is what it is.
We gave no consideration to the naming.
We gave little consideration
to any
of this.
Very slapdash effort here. We just threw it up.
It's a live stream. What do you expect?
Yeah. I want to quickly point out Scott Sullivan in the comments of my feed, because we're broadcasting this on both channels, said, does anyone remember Talk and Talker? And I am so glad someone does.
Oh, my God.
Adam and I tried, I think, two episodes of a podcast that we couldn't really get off the ground. This is before you could just podcast from anywhere. It was a little harder to get it like published and out. And I don't know that we had the reception or the ideas. And we're like, it just kind of fizzled. Neither one of us were passionate about it. But yeah, this is potentially the long dormant sequel.
That's right. I'm sure you have too, of several failed experiments in podcasting world. I had one with my buddy DJ Bless. He wanted to be called Movies with My Black Friend. And that was fun to do. He'd come
over.
That
was his idea?
That was his idea, yeah.
Great.
He's like, because every time I'd get together with him for like the first year, he's like, you are the whitest fucking guy I've ever met in my life. I'm like, thank you? Why do you have to pull the race card, dude?
That's so, too funny.
Yeah, so he's like, it's called Movies with My Black Friend. It'll get traction just because the name is so outrageous. I'm like, yeah, that's fair. But yeah, he got so busy mixing audio and all that, you know, work stuff. Anywho, John, do you want to jump into the first category?
Yes. Do we have an order for the categories?
I think we'll just go down our list here. We have five picks, it looks like, for biggest snub. Five picks each. Some of these only have two, some have five, some have three.
We can talk about them quickly or long. It don't matter.
It don't matter. Some of them are going to be quick because I don't have a whole lot to say, but I have a lot of emotions behind them. Do you want to start?
I will. I would love to start. Thank you.
Okay, please do.
So for biggest snub, we both picked five nominees from any category. And I didn't rank mine, so I'll just go right off the bat. If you can't tell from the bluely lit corner of my office here, I am a huge fan of Back to the Future. And my biggest Oscar snub is that my favorite movie of all time was not nominated for Best Picture. It was nominated for a few key categories. I think it came closest, I think, to most competitive in the screenplay category, but it was nominated for three or four Oscars. So it was on the Academy's radar. And I think in a year where they had 10 nominees like they do now, and they have for the last 15 years, where they expanded it to 10, I think Back to the Future would have got a nomination. It was competitive in some of those technical categories. It was the number one highest grossing film of the entire year, but nothing in the Best Picture race. And what won that year is trash, and we'll talk about it later.
Hollywood is not – it's always been this way. That's the one thing that annoys me about the awards is they just don't give a shit about blockbusters or sci-fi typically in general. It's kind of snubbed. Same with horror. Sci-fi and horror, it seems like
– and comedy.
They just don't care.
You really only have a chance if you do drama and maybe musicals.
Drama and musicals, yeah. Well, I mean, there are some exceptions, obviously, which I have a couple on my list, which are good. But
like the fact that we had The Way of Water nominated last year is incredible. And like Avatar had no chance of winning, but I'm so glad that Avatar was one of the 10 nominees. It's like, well, at least you're acknowledging that these movies still exist, because for a long time, the Academy was like, no, if it doesn't have Meryl Streep or Daniel Day-Lewis in it, we don't care. I don't care how much money it has or how many visual effects you invented. Like Jurassic Park, never got a nomination. I get it. I get it. Same year as Schindler's List, but come on, Jurassic Park? Any other year, that should be probably winning.
I am sure you were talking the whole time. Did you notice that I just completely failed out of screen?
I assumed you needed to pick your nose or...
This happened in another StreamYard that I did with another guest, and I don't know if it has to do with the fact that I'm now recording, or I'm doing the live stream from my iPhone 15. There's a feature they added where you can stream right from the phone. But it's happened twice now, and I don't like it, John. I don't like it.
If it keeps happening, I will do my best to...
Please.
To what's the word? To represent you well and honorably.
I mean, honestly, you should just do this entire stream with the operation that I'm not here ever. That's probably for the best. Just kind of ignore me all around.
As soon as you drop off, Adam's such a piece of shit. Fucking asshole.
I mean, you could say that when I'm here, too. Speaking of Adam's a piece of shit, two things to address, because I know people are just dying to hear it. I am very happy Godzilla Minus One won best VFX, guys. I said it in my review. It looks beautiful. It had a very small, meager budget. Yeah, it should have won. I can hate a movie that looks pretty, and I didn't hate Godzilla Minus One. I just didn't like it very much. And also, The Boy and the Heron, or whatever that boring shit was, the most overrated Studio Ghibli crap. I love Studio Ghibli, but that movie, I took my son. We were bored to tears. People were leaving the theater. I just don't understand why people are pretending that this was a great movie when it was not.
I think, like most Oscars for older people, was a makeup. Like, oh, shoot, we haven't given Miyazaki anything since Spirited Away. Okay, here's another one for this one.
Well, and it's granted, I have not seen his last movie. It's his last movie too, so they're kind of just, you know, jerking him off, I guess. But
I mean, this happens all the time. Like, well off the rails at this point. But Al Pacino, for example, won for Scent of a Woman, which is a fine film and a good performance. But it's like, this is obviously, we really goofed. We didn't give it him for Tony Montana or for Michael Corleone. Like, all right,
I got one of those later on my list. Yeah. But all that said about The Boy and the Heron, visually stunning. And I totally understand why it won Best Animation.
I'm excited to watch that and Godzilla, which I haven't seen either one of those yet.
I'm excited to watch Godzilla Minus One with my family to see what they think about it. And if maybe
Lindsay's going to turn to you and be like, I can't believe you've done this. I can't believe... She slides
the divorce paper across the table. Like, this is it. This is the Godzilla that broke the camel's back.
Yep.
All right, let's get to my pick. We're really like
12 minutes later.
I don't know the year. Hang on. I gotta look up the year it came out, because that's
important. I want to say 2015.
2014. You were really damn close.
Real close. You were really close. I'm good at that.
In 2014, a movie and an actor were snubbed beyond all comprehension. I'm talking about Jake Gyllenhaal in Nightcrawler. The name says it all. It really is kind of a disturbing film about a guy willing to lie, cheat, steal, and do whatever, move bodies across the ground and film them just so he can be first to market, make a name for himself, get in the best time slot on the news. Gyllenhaal freaking knocked this performance out of the park, and there's not even a mention. There's not even a whisper of him at the Oscars. It was disgusting.
This would absolutely... I saw that you wrote it down, so I didn't include it in my top five, but this might actually be my number one biggest snub in history. He's maybe my favorite working actor today.
He's fantastic.
Ryan Gosling is also, after what he did Sunday night with the live song and dance... It's obvious that this guy can do no wrong. Yeah. Everyone he's ever worked with loves him. He can do comedy. But Jake Gyllenhaal is like, this guy has been great for 30 years. He was playing Billy Crystal's kid in City Slickers in 1991. He's been doing this for my entire life, pretty much. And Nightcrawler was one of my favorite performances of the decade. Didn't even get a nomination.
He's incredibly flexible with his performances. He's just such a workhorse actor, too. You know he's reliable. I am curious to see how Roadhouse goes, but early reactions are saying it's at least a fun, dumb action movie again. So, okay.
Well, it'll be on Amazon Prime any week now, so no reason to rush out to a theater where it could make money when it can lose money right at home. Oh. My second nomination is also a poster on my wall. Is this one right here, Avengers Endgame. I recognize that it probably was not going to ever get reasonable or real traction as a Best Picture nominee. But Alan Silvestri's musical score, I think, is the best work he's ever done. Forrest Gump, Castaway, Back to the Future, Endgame, I think, is better than all of those soundtracks. And didn't even get a nomination for it. And that really bugs me, because it's one of my favorite pieces of orchestral music in the last 10 years.
Yeah,
and it was, it's like that. That seems like a category where like you should be able to put in stuff from Marvel. Like that, Marvel can usually handle some of those lower. Marvel's never going to win a Best Picture. Black Panther came the closest, but like even you can't even give him a score. Alan Silvestri, this guy's been around. Like,
yeah, he's got a catalog like not many others can.
I mean, John Williams gets like 60 nominations. I think Silvestri's only had like 3 or 4. And it's like, I get that he's not going to win every time, but not even a nomination.
And for Endgame, it makes the most sense too, because there's been criticisms. I've had them in the past of earlier Marvel stuff where there never really seemed to be good theme songs for any of the characters.
They feel like temp music.
Yeah, right. It felt very stock. And then Silvestri comes in and he really tied a lot of those old themes into the main theme. And I thought it works just so brilliantly. It was much like the movie itself being a culmination of everything that came before it. The music was the same. Yeah, it's a disappointment, John. I'm with you. I'm with you. Here's
what
one
do you got for
number
two?
I mean, these aren't in order. I should say that right now because I am still...
Yeah, mine were unranked. We're just listing them off.
I'm still kind of... upset about this one, but Iron Claw being snubbed in every single category at the Oscars this
still
year.
Still haven't seen this one either, but I have heard great, great things. And I know you said it was one of your favorites of the whole year, right?
It was my favorite of last year. Yeah, I wasn't expecting a lot from it because A24 is so hit and miss with me. And this one looked like it might be too artsy, but it was just, I thought it matched the tone really perfectly. And I felt some emotion, which I can't say I felt a lot of in the movies in 2023. It's a shame that this was MIA from the Oscars this year. Academy Awards. Some people don't know they're the same thing because it's such terrible branding. Academy Awards, the Oscars, it's all the same.
I'm too deep in it and I'm so close to it. Do people actually think Academy Awards and Oscars are two different? Like bodies?
I shit you not. Like, I get confused because there's also the Emmys, there's the Tonys, there's too many names floating around, and then some of them are close together. The Golden Globes.
We don't need the Globes. The Globes are redundant in two different ways. We already have TV and we already have movies. We don't need one that combines both over dinner. We don't want to watch celebrities eating salad when they're trying to win awards. It's awkward for everybody. Globes are like the redheaded stepchild, and it's just...
The best thing that came out of the Globes were Ricky Gervais roasting the shit out of celebrities two different times. That was
my fantastic. I don't know if you caught the Globes this past year. I didn't, but I did see what is his name? Joe Coy, this Latino comic who by all accounts is funny in other places, just absolutely bombed on the Globe stage with like crickets, just nobody laughing. And he's throwing women under the bus. He's throwing Barbie under the bus. And it's like, do you know what room you're in? Do you know what this crowd is? Like, he's like, yeah, these people suck. And it's like, what? Terrible
yeah.
jokes.
Yeah.
Go back and watch that if you want to die.
I'd rather not.
Secondhand cringe.
I'd rather not. What do you
he's,
got?
Oh, he's Asian? He's not Latino? Well, that goes what I know.
What do you got at three?
I have, this is another one that is such an obvious Oscar snub. They actually reconfigured the category so that you could include more movies because when The Dark Knight was not nominated for Best Picture in 2008, the Academy was like, okay, you're right, our bad. Next year we'll do 10 nominees. That way we can include some of these more popular films. And yeah, The Dark Knight, it's Christopher Nolan's, I think, best movie.
Ooh,
there's a lot of argument. You could say Interstellar, you could say Prestige.
I'd say both of those above Dark Knight.
They're all fantastic. Yeah. And I would actually have to really think about it. But The Dark Knight at the time was probably his best movie.
I mean, at the end of the day, you're arguing like best versus best, right? It's kind of
they're all fantastic films.
Yeah.
I think at the time that was the real renaissance of comic book movies. 2008 kicked off the MCU, and DC had their best ever movie, $1 billion. And the Academy wanted to nominate it, but they're like, oh, we want to, but we don't have room. It's like, well, you guys make the rules. So the next year, when it was too late, they're like, okay, we'll give you 10.
The Dark Knight for me. But we have an artsy black and white movie that we want to promote that no one's heard about yet.
Yeah. Are you talking about Nebraska?
No.
Bruce Dern?
No.
Because that, that was nominated a couple years later. And that
wasn't Maestro a black and white artsy movie?
Every year there seems to be one movie that's like, what if we filmed it monochromatic? That's artsy. No, it isn't. It's not inherently artsy just because you dropped the saturation.
And not only that, everybody, every celebrity has already seen this movie and they love it. And no mainstream person's even heard of the fucking thing. It hasn't even hit theaters yet. And they're like, oh yeah, that was a brilliant piece of work. Like, what movie is this?
I am actually really curious how consistently we have at least one nominee in black and white. So this year we had a few because Maestro and Oppenheimer had black and white sequences.
That's true.
Zone of Interest had some black and white. Technically, they were infrared, but we had some black and white there. You read your next one. I'm just going to quietly read through this list for more.
Well, mine is another movie snub from Sir Stanley Kubrick. Best Picture, 1969, 2001, A Space Odyssey. Not even mentioned. Nowhere to be found on the list.
I don't think they had visual effects for a category back then either, because this was the 1960s and they didn't even have computers in the conventional sense.
Yeah.
I am not a big fan of this movie. I reviewed it many years ago and said it was just all right. And people hated me for that. So I know a thing or two about your Godzilla Minus One going out on a limb and saying thing is bad.
The thing is, I could totally see people hating 2001 A Space Odyssey. It's very much an art piece. It's got a lot of things to say, and I'm not sure the messages are that clear. But I appreciate it being incredibly bold, especially in that time period. If I showed that to Lindsay, my wife, she would hate me, and she wouldn't talk to me for a
quarter. When I watched it, I was like 23 years old. I had probably only seen like 700 movies in my entire life. I've seen 5,000 more since then, and I feel like I would really appreciate its place in the sort of cinematic canon of American lineage and probably be like, wow, this is actually really good and impressive, and I appreciate what it's doing, even if I don't enjoy it.
I'm sure most people didn't even realize that intro in Barbie was from Space Odyssey. They probably thought, oh, this is
I hope they did, but I'm more optimistic than you.
Yeah, I can't imagine they did.
That's a good pick, though. I feel like when you look back historically on other movies that were nominated in, let's see, in 1969, the movies that were nominated, Midnight Cowboy, Anne of a Thousand Dances, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, Hello, Dolly, and Z. I've seen three of those.
Yeah.
Hello, Dolly, Butch Cassidy, and Midnight Cowboy. Yeah. And admittedly, those are all really great films.
They are.
And personally, I would put them above 2001. But I think when you talk about like the pantheon of American cinema, 2001 is way more influential than any one of those.
I mean, just I'm afraid I can't let you do that. The HAL computer, the way he shoots the movie, or the guys walking through the ship, and everything about it.
He came up with iPads. He invented a little iPad conceptually as a movie prop, like four decades before it was a real. Like that's forward thinking when you could come up with technology that hasn't existed or doesn't exist yet.
Right.
Let's see, my fourth pick, and this is one I know a fellow reviewer of ours on YouTube, Dan Murrell,
do you know his info? I should try to have him on the show sometime.
I do not know anything in terms of his private information. I don't know if he knows I exist.
Okay.
He got started on YouTube on his own channel after I had left, so our careers don't really overlap. But Dan Murrell loves my next nominee, which is Toni Collette in Hereditary.
Oh, yeah.
One of the scariest movies I've ever seen, probably certainly of like this decade, the last 10 years or so. Hereditary is a absolute, just like gangbusters coming at you.
Ari Aster, right?
Yeah, that movie is intense. And all of it is Toni Collette. Like her performance is just like, she's wigged out of her mind. She is going through like all five stages of grief on like a speed run. And it is intense to watch her go through it. And I'm really surprised that you mentioned it at the top of the show, right? It was a horror movie.
Wait, wasn't she up for Best Actress for that?
No.
She wasn't nominated even?
She wasn't even nominated.
What? She was. What was she nominated for? She was nominated
She has been nominated for other things, but not that.
Wow.
That's crazy.
That's silly. That's silly.
And I think a big reason is it was a horror movie.
Yeah.
That was a more conventional drama about a mother dealing with the death of her child and like the grief that rips apart her family. Easily would have been nominated, probably even won. But because there's like freaky deaky stuff and people on the ceiling, forget it. Can't handle
it. And a daughter getting her head decapitated by a sign. Yeah.
Just forget about it. And that's really frustrating because I watched that recently. I didn't watch it when it came out. And I was like, oh my God, why isn't everyone still talking about this every week? Incredible film.
It is an incredible film. And you know what else is an incredible film? The Truman Show.
Yes.
Specifically because of Jim Carrey and his performance he put in 1998. Yet, no best actor nomination for that guy. And honestly, it's a shame because I think Jim Carrey, John, we've done an entire video on Jim Carrey.
We sure did.
On your channel. But
we did. I'm glad you remember that.
You know, some comedians are incredibly flexible with their range, and Jim Carrey is flexible both physically and emotionally. And Truman Show was one of the first times he really showcased to people, I'm not just Ace Ventura, I'm not just Dumb and Dumber, I can do serious with comedy still blended in. And man, he sold me on that performance. And when he leaves that soundstage at the end, he says this catchphrase, oof, it was hard to keep your eyes dry. And yeah, it's a bummer that he was completely...
What's wild about Jim Carrey in Truman Show is, I know we just threw a lot of shade at the Globes being a redundant and pointless award ceremony. He won the Globe that year for the Truman Show. But not receive a counterpart nomination in the Oscars, which is rare. It's usually the same, like, six or seven people get nominations at both, and the winner is often the same in both. And when it's not, it's usually at least a nominee from the other show. The fact that he wasn't even nominated but did win is like, whoa, what happened? How did the Academy miss something that the foreign press at the Globes picked up on? And what's crazier is, despite the fact that he's been nominated for a BAFTA and a Globe and a bunch of MTV movie awards, he has never to date been nominated for any Academy Awards. Not for Eternal Sunshine, not for Man on the Moon, not for Truman Show, not for Dr. Robotnik and Sonic 2. Like nothing he has done. I mean, I will put it out there, Adam, that when he crawled out of that mechanical rhino in When Nature Calls, that alone should get, if there were Oscars for comedy, that is one of my all-time favorite scenes, full stop.
It's so good.
It is incredible.
The rhino's giving birth, children.
it is the funniest scene I think he's ever done, and
it's
that
great.
Is a very high bar.
And I don't think Ace Ventura 2 is great, but that scene alone is so good.
I think I saw that in the theater with my dad, and we were both pissing ourselves laughing.
I saw it in the theater on my birthday, actually. It was like
that's
the greatest.
Great.
Yeah, it was awesome.
That's great.
Yeah, it's sad that he hasn't been nominated. But Jim Carrey, at this point in his career, I don't think Jim Carrey gives a shit.
I don't think he does. But I think if he keeps acting and he keeps taking serious roles, he's at that age where he'll start doing like prestige pictures. And he'll pick up an award the way that Robin Williams did, by doing a really kind of Oscar-friendly drama. If Jim
He did that with The Majestic, and it got basically no notice at all.
That is a good point. I think he still has a lot of career left if he chooses to go that way. I know his movie selection lately has been interesting.
Well,
it doesn't.
He retired, I think.
Right, he retired for a bunch of time. Then he came back and did a few things. I mean, he's in the new Sonic movies.
I think he's in Sonic 2.
He is. He's in one and two, and I think he's coming back.
Oh,
for three.
I'm sorry. I apologize. I don't think he's coming back for three. He's not listed on IMDb.
No.
They've done no like press tour or anything about him coming back. So I don't know. I'm not sure he's back.
Jim Carrey reprising his role. All right, you heard it here first. Adam,
we got him. We got him. Okay, that's fine. I'm happy.
George Bush on the aircraft carrier. Mission
accomplished. Mission
accomplished. We got him.
The Trump dance. All right. On that sad note, you have one more for the biggest snub.
Oh, that's right. That's right. My last biggest snub is Amy Adams in Arrival. Arrival was nominated for, I think, 10 Oscars in 2016, another film by the great Denis Villeneuve.
Villeneuve. Yeah,
it's tricky. I had to practice that for my Dune video, and I still got it wrong. That was one of his best films from, 8 years ago now. It got 10 nominations, Best Picture, Screenplay, Cinematography, Editing, all these. But Amy Adams in the lead role pretty much carries that movie by herself.
It's her movie. What the hell?
She's talking to a mute octopus behind glass. She's
talking to a CG thing.
And she didn't even get nominated. That's crazy. Let me see who won that year in 2016. I understand why she might not have won.
Right.
But the fact that none of the people we've mentioned, Gyllenhaal or Jim Carrey, Alan Silvestri, or whatever, not even getting nominated. It's like, what are you doing?
There's been some movies like that where you just scratch it. Because didn't Margot Robbie get snubbed from Best Actress for Barbie? And Barbie was up like 50 awards. It just kind of seemed weird that she wouldn't get a nod even. I mean, just.
Yeah, so Best Actress in 2016, Emma Stone won for La La Land, which, fair. I actually probably would have given
La La Land's phenomenal.
Isabel Huppert in Elle, Ruth Negga in Loving, Natalie Portman in Jackie, and Meryl Streep in Florence Foster Jenkins. I haven't even seen three of those movies.
All of them
have just like completely disappeared from the public consciousness. Meanwhile, Adams and Arrival are still very much relevant in like who's
I
honestly
mean, they're more relevant is, for
who
sure.
Who is Ruth Negga? I am terminally online. I watch a movie a day. I've never heard of her.
I feel like Austin Powers. Who are these people?
That's my thought on that.
I agree. Arrival was awesome, and it was because
it was great film.
I mean, she was
fantastic great. Movie,
and she carried that thing. Okay, I have Shawshank Redemption. Now, John, we did talk about this, and I am cheating here because I'm pretty sure Shawshank Redemption was up for some nominations at the Oscars in 1995.
It took home nothing.
It took home nada. Zilch.
Is that right? I thought it won for like music.
It won for participating in the Oscars, and that's it. It didn't win shit.
That is frustrating.
And yes, admittedly, 1995 was a banger of a year for movies. You had
94.
Oh, 94?
Yeah, it came out in 94.
Oh, well, then you had Pulp Fiction. You had what won?
I just had the full list right.
Tom Hanks.
Forrest Gump won.
Forrest Gump, thank you. Yeah.
Four Weddings and a Funeral, Pulp Fiction, Quiz Show, Shawshank. Four Weddings is okay, but the other four movies are excellent. I don't know if you've seen Quiz Show or if you haven't seen it recently. That's a great movie.
Okay.
But yeah, Shawshank is the best movie in that group by a country mile. And I love Forrest Gump, and I think Pulp Fiction is also exceptionally strong.
I don't know a single person on the planet that doesn't like Shawshank Redemption.
One of the most satisfying experiences I think I've ever had in a theater.
Yeah.
I went in totally blind. I didn't see it in 94. I watched it like a rescreening. It was like a local theater.
Oh, sure.
One night only of Shawshank. Yeah. I'm like, I've never seen it. I know it's supposed to be good. And I just sat back and watched. And I'm like, oh, this is kind of depressing, actually. All right, it's one of those, like, depressing period. I'm like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. And I was weeping. I was on the floor. I was just, like, thrilled. My mouth was down. I was like, oh, this is so good.
Well, because they put you through the ringer with those
characters. Yeah, I think that's why it works so good.
It's such a roller coaster. And then they had, you know, Red goes back to the same place where his buddy died years earlier. You see the writing on the wall, and you're like, oh God, he's gonna hang himself, and Andy Dufresne's not gonna get out, and it just ends so beautifully on that beach, and it doesn't end beautifully for them at the awards ceremony, but that's okay. That's okay.
That's the real title card right after Red and Andy meet up in Zeynep. Zay Watanahu. There's a title card that says they did not win any Oscars.
Andy Dufresne's a tall drink of water who went home empty-handed yet again.
So on the Wikipedia page, right next to footnote 99, it did not win in any category.
Sad.
So it was up. So of the seven, it was up for picture. Best actor for Morgan Freeman. Best adapted screenplay for Frank Darabont. Best cinematography for Roger Deakins. Thankfully, Roger eventually won like 20 years later. But Jesus, that's one of the most well-shot movies I've ever seen.
Yeah.
Best film editing, best sound, and best original score by Newman, who was that was his first. I thought Newman won for that one. That's frustrating.
Randy Newman?
No, the other one.
joking. Your cone's no, red.
Is it Thomas Newman? Howard Newman?
Getting
what's his
rid
name?
Of sand now.
Thomas Newman. Yeah, I thought so.
I always think of the Randy Newman Family Guy.
Yeah.
Fat walking man over. Walking over. Before we get into the next category, let me read off a couple super chats, and I appreciate you for bringing them in. There's just a few here. We have Michael for $1.99. Your son slept in so he can spirit away. That's in reference to the boy and the heron, I imagine. Yeah, okay. Fair.
Yeah, you got to read these more timely. That came in like 18 minutes ago.
That's all right. They just have to know. I'm going to read them in between categories, folks.
There you go.
Hack the Movies, $2. Tony is livid that he's not on this show tonight. He's livid. Human
he's
going to
get in any way he can.
Human Centipede 2 was black and white. Very artsy, in all caps. Yes, it was. Tony, I think just did... I don't know if he watched all three of the Human Centipede movies or if he just did the first movie.
Three? I thought there were like 12. Are there only three?
I think there's only three. It's a trilogy, which makes sense because
I'm thinking of Saw.
Saw, there's 10 of them so far. Thank you, Tony. Yes, very artsy.
First sequence, independent body horror film, yada, yada. I have not seen any of the Human Centipede films. I am not
in a
rush.
Consider yourself fortunate. Yeah. The Blind Mask for $5. Thank you, Blind Mask. Harry Potter never winning any awards for even music, sets, makeup, or effects is crazy to me. Is this true? Harry Potter's never won anything ever?
It might be, actually. I know John Williams didn't win for his score, which
Holy
I think
shit.
Is probably the most competitive part of those films. But like they don't knock anybody's socks off with the effects or the editing or the sound. But I feel the visuals probably could have been competitive.
I mean, costume and set design.
And I also feel
won.
Like adapted screenplay could have been.
Adapted screenplay. Music should have been a no-brainer. But, I mean, if we're going to give awards out willy-nilly to films like Suicide Squad, I think we should be able to give Harry Potter at least
one. I don't
one.
Know if you could see how big my eyes just rolled, but they went through the back of my head and came around the other side.
That's what I said when some people were being smartasses on Twitter. Like, oh, Adam, how do you feel about Godzilla getting an Oscar on? I'm like, yeah, well, it's sitting right up there proudly with the Suicide Squad for Oscar wins.
Oh, boy.
Or is it the... I'm sorry, is it Suicide Squad? Which one was first?
It's the first one, Suicide, not The.
Okay, not The. Wow, just amazing titling over in Hollywood, isn't it?
No, it's embarrassing. There was a... if you ever want to go down a fun rabbit hole, look at anything Sylvester Stallone's done. Right, both Rambo and Rocky just have – Rocky's actually a little better, but the Rambo, First Blood, and then there's – what is it called? Rambo,
well, there's
colon,
First Blood,
First Blood Part 2.
Yeah.
No, but it's Rambo, colon, First Blood Part
yes,
2.
Yes, yes.
And then Rambo 3, even though there was never a Rambo 1 or 2.
And then it's Rambo, right?
And then just Rambo. And then the fifth one is
– Well, Rambo was retitled from John Rambo to Rambo.
In some markets. So when they came out with the fifth one, in those markets, they had to call it Rambo, Last Rambo. And in here, we just got, I think, Rambo 5? I forget.
It was Last Blood. No, it was Rambo Last Blood.
It was Last Blood. That's what they called it.
What the fuck does that mean, Last Blood?
It's all over the map. And in different countries, they use different titles.
The first one makes sense because he even says it. They drew First Blood. They drew First Blood. He doesn't say that in the last one. They drew Last Blood. God, it's so stupid. Oh,
tremendous.
I love it. All right, John. All right. The next category is only two each, so we'll be going quick through this one. This is worst Oscar moments. Just embarrassing.
These are all automatic nominees. It doesn't matter who talks about them, but I know we'll all have fun stories to share.
Yes.
But in the last 10 years or so, what are some of the most memorable moments at the Oscars telecast for being bad?
Well, the one I have really rings true to me because I am horrible at pronouncing names. I'm really horrible at just talking in general, I think. But John Travolta coming out on that stage and butchering the living hell out of... John, please say the name for me.
It's Idina Menzel.
Idina Menzel. And he said something like... I don't
Adele
even know what
Dazeem.
Adele Dazeem.
Not only does he say Adele Dazeem, he really like leans into it, Adele Dazeem. And it's like, dude, I've never been so confident when I'm that wrong in my life.
He was like so proud.
Adele Dazeem.
Whisks away. I mean, seriously.
And then the camera just pans over and she has to then perform Let It Go. That was the introduction for her breakout mainstream crossover hit. She went from Broadway to movies My daughters love that song to this day. Mm-hmm. And her first introduction to most of Middle America was Adele Dazeem.
And ironically, she had to let it go on the spot and just move on with the performance.
Yeah. Because if I were her, I would have been like, really?
Okay. This stuff's rehearsed, right? I mean, he should have known about this ahead of time. He doesn't just get a card and he's told, like, say this right now.
I assume he had a prompter and maybe just couldn't read it or just decided to wing it. Or maybe they didn't have the phonetic spelling in there. I've done presentations on the stage for big award shows before.
Right.
With all the people staring at you and the lights and the teleprompters at the back of the house. It's like 100 feet away. And even at like 38-point font, that can be tough to read because I'm looking into a crowd of people. And it's like, oh, hi, everyone. And then it's like, oh, I got to find there's my teleprompter. And sometimes it's easy to lose sight of I've been there.
I could imagine.
On a much smaller scale in terms of stress and pressure. But that said, I feel like, if you know who you're presenting.
That's what I'm saying. He should have known who it was. It's one line of dialogue.
Yeah, I had my script a couple days in advance, and I did my best to memorize it. And even still, I'm like, I'm just going to follow the prompter just to make sure I don't throw anything in at the last minute because I have a tendency to do that. And I got through it okay, I think. I haven't actually watched back the tape. That'd be a little embarrassing.
He should have just Pacino'd it and completely skipped who's singing it. Just went right to
my eyes. My eyes see Adele Dazeem.
No, he should have just done presenting Frozen. All right. That's it. He's done. Okay. Frozen. Okay.
That would have been great.
For some reason, he goes Pacino.
That was your first nominee in the worst or most embarrassing Oscar moment.
Yeah, another one I was going to like bring up, but then I thought, oh, she's just so damn cute and likable because she always falls, would be Jennifer Lawrence just tripping and falling constantly. But that's just her thing. You know, she's so relatable.
I would agree. I give her the pass because that's a very honest, relatable mistake. And the rest of these are all kind of like, somebody screwed up bad.
Somebody screwed up real bad.
It was intention. So my first nominee is, I think, probably will go down famously as the worst unforced error in the history of
I know
the
where
Academy
you're going
Awards,
with it.
Which is when Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway announced that La La Land had won Best Picture for all of 3 minutes
until
PricewaterhouseCooper was like, oh, the wrong award. You read the one for Best Actress. I must go on this, not the right one. And then the guys for La La Land are giving their acceptance speech, and they're like, it turns out we didn't win. Sorry. And then they all just walk off the stage in a huff. Thankfully, the producer, Matt Horowitz, stayed at the mic and was like, this is not a joke, everyone. Moonlight wins Best Picture. And it's such an iconic moment that he took what was easily probably the most embarrassing and crushing moment of his life.
Yeah.
We have his greatest professional achievement ripped away from him in the middle of his acceptance.
So he
turned that on its head and he's like, no, I'm going to give this to my friends over there. Parasite or Moonlight, you won. You guys, come on up. Take this award from me. I'm literally going to give you my award. It was such a thankless and selfless moment from him and the La La Land group. But from the perspective of the crew and the people that guard these envelopes, PricewaterhouseCooper and the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, like, is there a bigger blunder than mixing up envelopes, not just in any category, but the last award, the biggest one of the whole night.
The biggest one, yeah. And more insulting is the fact that La La Land should have won anyways, so it was even more frustrating.
I think because La La Land was up for like 13 or 14 nominations.
Yeah.
It was the runaway favorite in every category. And when it did win, everyone was like, oh, for sure, that makes sense. It was a great film. And Moonlight is too, but I think my preference would be for La La Land. And
I don't know, John, did you see at the time any memes? Because this is what instantly sprung to my mind, but the movie might not be that relevant to people. But Derek Zoolander going out there and accepting the award for Male Model of the Year for like the fourth year in a row. And he goes, a lot of people told me I couldn't do this 4 years in a row. Well, I guess I showed. And then they take the award away. That was exactly what happened.
I don't remember specifically, but that sounds like something the internet would have done instantly.
That's what they should have done.
Instantly.
That's what I did in my head. Yeah. All right. Well, mine, I mean, we should probably save this for last, because I why don't you do your other one? Because mine's so obvious.
Okay. Another unforced error. Really, this one's less terrible, and it actually proves that there isn't this malevolent, predetermined force. The Oscars are not rigged, because during the COVID year, when they had the ceremony at Union Station instead of the Dolby Theater, they decided to end the entire night, not on Best Picture as they had the previous 93 years, but instead, let's save Best Actor for last, because we are really sure our dearly departed, recently deceased friend Chadwick Boseman is going to win for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. So let's do Best Actor last.
Okay.
And that way we can end the show with this really moving, virtue signaling tribute for the 43-year-old Chadwick Boseman.
Right?
That's what we can do. But instead, Best Actor goes to Anthony Hopkins, who isn't here. He's asleep in Wales. Well, I guess that's our show. Good night, everyone.
The old white guy wins again.
What? And it's such, I mean, and truthfully,
yeah.
I thought Hopkins deserved it. His work in The Father is breathtaking. It's heartbreaking. It's so good. But when you end the show on, and we accept it on his behalf, good night. That's such an anticlimactic.
That's brutal.
Just pull the rug out and what? I remember sitting there going like...
It was like a bait and switch. They just did it to get people to watch to the end because they thought something was going to happen, but nothing did.
Yeah, no, it was such a funny anticlimactic moment. And it's proof that the Academy really doesn't know who's going to win each award before it happens. Because if they had predetermined it, they would have definitely put that in its traditional slot, like second or third to the end. Are you still there? You froze on my end.
What?
Yeah. Can you still hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. You're moving.
Cool. All right. Well, you go ahead. What is our last worst Oscars moment?
Well, John, there's only been two times in my life so far where I've watched something live with a level of horror on my face that I could not explain. The first was when the two towers were hit by planes.
It was probably when we were in high school and
I was in college. I saw that live on the screen because it was just randomly up for some reason at school. And the second one was Will Smith bitch slapping fucking Chris Rock live on TV because Chris Rock told the most lame, complimentary joke about alopecia and his wife. Keep my wife's name out your fucking mouth. Oof. I saw that live and I, like I said, we don't watch the Oscars ever. It was just kind of on in the background and we heard this and we look over and Lindsay's like, Adam, Will Smith just freaking went up and hit Chris Rock. I go, yeah, it's a bit, you know, I'm just thinking, it's a bit. Yeah, They're doing a thing. It's staged. And then he goes back to his seat and he's still cussing him out and going off. And I thought, wow, Will Smith's not that good of an actor. That's
I clued
crazy.
In. I think that it was so the discourse online that evening was impossible to look away from. And it was so frustrating because for every person on the internet, you know, there's an equal and opposite moron that just is an idiot. They believe all the stupid things. And that night, I remember on Twitter, everyone going, oh, it's a bit. And I'm like, are you people all stupid? When he went back to his seat, ABC dumped the audio for like 45 full seconds.
Yeah.
There is no way
doesn't
a podcast
happen.
With 20 million people is just going to like the audio technician is just laying on that dump button. Like, don't bring the audio back. He's still swearing. And you can see it, like the audience reactions. Lupita Nyong'o's right behind him going like.
I was waiting for the Curb Your Enthusiasm music. The Curb music to kick in.
It just zooms in. I was kind of in the same boat. I'm watching it live, and he walks up and slaps on him. I was kind of like, that was kind of weird.
Yeah, that was
and
weird.
then when they start dumping the audio, and it kind of like skips forward a little bit, and I'm like, all right, something's either they had a technical issue, which could have happened, but more likely something's happening in the room, and they're trying to like cut away or cut around it. And then within a half an hour, someone on Twitter posted a link.
It was all over YouTube and Twitter.
They posted a link to, I want to say it was like the Chinese broadcast or the Chinese redub that was being simulcast there. And they didn't have the dump. So they had the original audio.
Yep.
And then you could hear it clear as day. Will Smith just keep my wife's name out your fucking mouth. And I'm like, God.
Well, and it was more telling watching Chris Rock just stand there completely dumbfounded. Oh, he was,
like, I've never seen him a loss for words in his life.
But you and also he was like, see, you can see when he's ready to pull the trigger on a comeback, and he holds himself like he holds himself professionally because he's like, oh God, I could freaking nail you right now, but I'm not gonna do it. I'm gonna pull back.
It was such a moment, and what was really. I think I'm not sure if I'm the one that made this. I mean, I'm sure we all kind of came to the same analogy at the same time, but it felt like you're at Thanksgiving dinner with the family, and then two of your family members, your parents or something, or your uncle and your mom get in a fight and some really nasty words are said.
Yeah.
And they're like, fine, we'll just go back to eating. And everyone's like, I'm like super uncomfortable. You guys were just screaming full volume and we're just expected to keep eating our mashed potatoes.
It's the Will Ferrell.
Right. The rest of the broadcast, I'm like, everyone's just going to go about handing out Questlove.
It was so Questlove weird.
Won the Oscar for best documentary immediately after this moment. And I'm like, I love Questlove. I love The Roots. Yeah. I love that it's like the best part of Jimmy Fallon's show. And he won his first Oscar. And everyone was like,
Did we say, and that just happened or something like that?
I don't know. But it put such a cloud over the rest of the show. Well, and everything was really awkward. And like, I literally watching at home was like secondhand embarrassed. I couldn't get comfortable. It was slap her around the world.
I was going to say your parent analogy reminded me of the Will Ferrell skit he did a couple times in SNL where he's at the family table. And I think Sarah Michelle Gellar is the teenage daughter. And they're just clinking their plates around with their silverware. And every once in a while, Sarah Michelle Gellar will be like, I hate you! And Will Ferrell will go off. And then they'll just uncomfortably clink their plates around and eat again. It's fantastic. But that's what this was. The slap heard around the world.
Yeah, it was that'll live in infamy as one of the most awkward and unfortunate and unchecked aggression. And what's crazy is an hour later, Will Smith won the Oscar for Best Actor. This like his entire career has been moving to this point.
Weird.
And he finally wins. And I wanted to be so happy for a guy I've been rooting for in some of my favorite movies for 20 years. And then the entire Oscar speech is him like sobbing through this like half-assed, undirected apology. Like he doesn't actually apologize to Chris or anything.
No.
He's just kind of like, I want to be a good role model for my girls. I'm like, dude, you failed. This is embarrassing. And it went from what would have been and should have been the best moment of his career to the worst in the space of 48 minutes or whatever. It was
and it managed to once again show how incredibly depressing humanity has become, because online you would imagine that 99% of the people would be like, wow, that was uncalled for, that was terrible. But no, it was like split. There were a lot of people going, good for him, standing up for his woman. And
remember. That was the other. There were three angles to that discourse. Was a good contingent thought it was fake. And I'm like, you guys need better media literacy training because you're morons. Yeah. And another huge contingent was like, a lot of people just, I think, just they went so hard to bat for him almost without even seeing the clip. Like they were just. Like it was an automatic allyship. Like, doesn't matter. Whatever Will Smith did, I'm on his side. I'm like, did you actually watch the tape?
Because it's so crazy.
Really damning.
Yeah.
And for whatever reason, people went to bat for him after he just committed pretty unnecessary violence on national TV.
really unnecessary.
Just really. Like, I'm trying. What's a good word for when you just? Yeah. I don't know.
Robbie 214, $4.99 super chat says, Will Smith's incident was just insane and La La Land winning, but not actually. we covered those. That's exactly right, Robbie. No more super chats, so we can move on to the next category. Are we on favorite Oscar moments?
Yeah, we can do that.
Let's do that. Favorite Oscar moments.
Alrighty then. I feel like this is almost a segment we need video evidence for, but I don't have any of the links pulled, so that might be we could hastily do that in the background, maybe.
Which one specifically on your numbered list here? Do you have any particularly that you need?
I would say as we go through them all, but it doesn't matter.
Can we find him on YouTube? Because I can pull it up.
Oh yeah, he's one of these. Just type in what I typed in.
I'll type it in, and
while you're searching, and you'll get StreamYard ready for the presentation.
Yes.
These again unranked, but one of my favorite Oscar moments is when Cuba Gooding Jr. won for Best Supporting Actor for Jerry Maguire in 1996. So the 97 Oscars, and he gets up on stage and is doing cartwheels. I think he does a backflip at one point. And he is just leaping out of the air for joy and in celebration. And it is such a fun moment. I love seeing good people celebrate good moments with just unbridled joy and adulation. And it is such a fun moment. And there's also a behind-the-scenes clip of the director of that telecast directing his, 30-camera arsenal. He's trying to get all the reaction shots and Cuba all at the same time. And if you ever want to go down a fun rabbit hole, that behind the scenes video is one of my favorite pieces of live directing behind the scenes. Yeah, let's play it real quick because it's a great moment for sure.
The Oscar goes to Cuba Gooding Jr. and Jerry Maguire.
I miss the five bucks. I like when they do that.
Yeah, I do.
I know I have a little bit of time, so I'm going to rush and say everybody, and you cut away. I won't be mad at you. Tom said, don't forget to thank your wife. I will never forget to thank my high school sweetheart and the mother of my children, Spencer and Mason. I love you, Sarah. And my parents who are here, Shirley and Cuba the First. And God, I love you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God, for putting me through what you put me through. But I'm here and I'm happy. I just want to, here we go, okay, I'm the studio, I love you, and Cameron Crowe, and Tom Cruise, I love you, brother, I love you, man, Derek Crowe, Sean Settles, Keith Butler, all my behind-the-scenes crew, Regina King, I love you, you did a great job when we made the movie, everybody involved with the movie, I love you, oh my goodness, here we are, I love you, I'm going to keep going, Harley Junior Agency, everybody, I love you.
Beautiful.
I love that he just charges right through the play music and he just keeps yelling louder and louder and people keep cheering and clapping and they love it.
And the Oscar goes to Ben Affleck and Matt Damon.
Is it still playing on you?
Yeah, it was still playing on me. Ben Affleck and Matt. That was the same awards. That was the year they went for Good Will Hunting. It's a good year. All right, what do you have for your favorite Oscar moment?
Jesus, did you hear all that or is that just on my end?
I heard YouTube, the Ben Affleck part, yeah.
Oh, YouTube is like blasting in my ears still. Sorry.
That's all right.
Technical difficulties. Let's go. Mine is, well, you know what? I have it pulled up. Let me just present it. And
I'll start pulling links and shoot them to you in the private chat.
Yeah, that would be great. That would be wonderful. Let me share this.
Actually, you know what I'll do? I will put the links in the Google Doc because that's where you're going to be looking.
Mm-hmm.
Also, turn the volume down like 30, 40%.
On my YouTube player?
Yeah. There you go.
We'll do that. All right.
Yeah. Let's see what we got.
This is Matt Stone and Trey Parker, stoned out of their mind. Actually, they're tripping on like LSD, I think, going to the Oscars in beautiful gowns flowing.
Kind of simple and kind of alien. I don't know.
Shout it. Tell us.
Okay, talk about a fashion statement. Now, two of you are nominated for Best Song, Blame Canada.
Matt's not.
Yes. I'm not.
We said we can't say anything about the dresses.
Nothing about the dresses.
No matter what they ask, don't say
anything. Guys, what about the dresses?
Why the dresses? And we go, magical night tonight. Just all the shirts are out.
Is that why you're in the dress? It's just such a magical evening, and everyone looks so spectacular. You know, we just wanted to be a part of it all.
It's a night of magic.
Only thing we could have done a little bit better is we could have put powdered sugar all over our noses.
I love that. I thought it was just ridiculous.
That's terrific. I don't think I've seen that clip before, let alone their explanations, which makes it funnier.
Yeah, that was. They were there for South Park Bigger, Longer, Uncuts, the animated
movie. Yeah, I think it was
movie.
Nominated for what, animated feature or song?
I think it they was might music. Have been, it was music. Yeah, musical or something. I don't know. Who cares?
I think they were nominated for one of the songs.
They made a mistake inviting those guys because they were high as a kite, tripping balls, and dressed up as, if you didn't notice, they were wearing Jennifer Lopez's dress from a couple years back and Gwyneth
Famous
Paltrow.
Dress. Yep.
So that was...
I didn't recognize Paltrow's dress, but Jennifer Lopez's green dress with the long leg slit is very
That's
famous.
Iconic. Yeah.
Very, very iconic for sure. What do you have for... Well, that was yours. Number seven.
Yeah.
So my number two, which I linked in the Google Doc, so feel free to click and load it up, this is one of those makeup awards, right? The Academy probably wanted to give Jack Palance an award at some point in his long, illustrious career. He did work from the Western Shane in like 1953 all the way up until the mid-90s. And he won for City Slickers in 1991. And when he got up on stage, he was trying to, and you can kind of skip ahead of the middle of the video. He wanted to kind of show everybody like, hey, I'm an old guy, but I can still do stuff. So he drops to the floor and starts doing one-handed push-ups as a 73-year-old. And the crowd goes nuts. It is such a fun clip.
Ready?
And these are the kind of things that the youth today need to be reminded of what the Oscars used to be like.
You do all these things. Like, for instance, you know, you go out there and you do these.
Look at this guy. For the rest of the night, Billy Crystal is just riffing on, like, oh, Jack Palance is on the Stairmaster right now. You'll have to come back later for him.
That's awesome.
Crowd
That's fantastic. Yeah, I think Billy Crystal recreated that years later at a different Academy Awards.
Oh, I think the very next year.
Oh, was it the next year? Okay.
Yeah, because Billy hosted 4 years in a row, and that was, I think, in the middle of those four. And because Jack won, he was an automatic re-invite next year to introduce the supporting actress. And yeah, Billy and him were in the movie together, so I guess they're at least professional friends. And the rest of the show, I've seen clips over the years. Billy's just taking the piss out of him every chance he gets about how Jack Palance is. Yeah, no, he'll be back later to get on the Legmaster and just in between bits. Who do you have, or what do you have for your next?
I Oscar have a little gem, movie? A little ditty from 1977.
Nice.
And I don't even want to. Let's just roll the clip, and you can see what I'm talking about here.
Thank you.
Look at this guy. Look at the size of that
collar. I don't know
about
anyone else, but I really feel it's a privilege to be here tonight, and I'm going to try my best to. But can't you feel I'm working?
We got Muhammad Ali and Sly Stallone on the stage together.
You stole my script. Don't you feel working here? No, I saw it. I watched the movie. You stole my script. All that was me. I'm the Apollo.
You can put me on for years.
Show me what you can really do. Show me what you can really do.
You know my real name, don't you?
No, show me.
Kid Salami.
Show the world what you can do. Come on, show me.
I can't tell if this is a planned bit. Sylvester looked legitimately surprised.
I can't tell either, but it's fantastic. And he genuinely thinks he's. I think he genuinely wants to fight Ali right there and see who can win. But no. He's having a good time.
I think it was real. I don't think he knew.
I don't think so.
I just got to say one thing. I may not win anything here tonight in the form of an Oscar, but I really feel it's an amazing privilege to be standing next to a 100% certified legend. And it's something I want to treasure for the rest of my life. Unbelievable. Thank you very, very much.
Yeah, great moment. Italian Stallion, Rocky Balboa going up against one of the greatest legends in boxing history.
I said that Rocky won, or rather, I thought Sylvester won an award that year. And I don't think he did. And that's a bummer. Rocky was nominated for a bunch, and it did win Best Picture. But that did not get credited to Sylvester because he was not a producer. So,
yeah.
And his screenplay was nominated, but he also did not win as a writer. That's kind of a bummer. I love that film. One of my favorites. My next best favorite Oscar moment, another great acceptance speech. The speech is okay. It's the getting to the stage that is an iconic moment from Roberto Benigni's acceptance walk-on for the best foreign language film in 1999, When Life is Beautiful won. Roll the clip, Adam. This is so great. Right from the beginning of the clip, I believe. I forget. He's clearly like over the moon to have even been invited to America to take part in this silly little song and dance show that we put on in Hollywood every year. And the fact that he won, he's just like climbing over, losing his balance. It's so fun.
This dog and pony show that we do every year.
Yeah, absolutely.
I can't find a great... This is probably the best I'm going to do with such short notice, but...
Just pull up an image.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. I was hoping to just kind of blow it up higher, but that's fine. We'll just do it like this. All right. Let me share the screen. This was a very iconic screenshot from the 2016... Wait, what year was this?
2014.
2014, you got...
Wow, that was 10 years ago?
This broke the internet more than Kim Kardashian's ass did.
Before Elon owned the platform formerly known as Twitter, the most retweeted, not reposted, most retweeted image in the site's history for 6 or 7 years. I think it wasn't dethroned until recently.
And it had the most retweets and views within the first hour of being up. You have so many people in here. So many people, lovable actors. Kevin Spacey, of course, being the top of everyone's list.
Can you zoom in on Kevin Spacey there? Can you blow him up?
Can we enhance?
Because Kevin's doing this like, eh? And it's such a smug face. And I love him as an actor, but not particularly fond of his work as a person. So that little smug like, hey, look at me. I think that's Angelina Jolie on the far right. Like, you just see the top of her head.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
Angelina Jolie. That's
Lupita Nyong'o poking out. It's really a who's who of actors. Brad Pitt. You got Ellen, Julia
Meryl
Roberts.
Meryl Streep, Julia Roberts, Jennifer this? Lawrence. Who's? I don't know who that is behind Meryl.
Can we enhance more? We cannot
enhance. Identify.
More. Identify. Who's this guy? Who's this guy over here?
I don't know. Somebody.
Man, yeah, there's just eyes and stuff poking out.
I remember when this happened, and I remember when they tweeted it, and then I was right there retweeting it. I wanted to be part of that moment.
You were right there in the crowd. You can see yourself.
That's me.
Hidden. You're behind.
That's
Meryl
me. That's
Street.
Me behind Jennifer. Actually, that was before I grew my beard out. That was me.
It's the best place to be.
I had third row at the Oscars. You don't remember that? I was up for. I was one of the extras in the Revenant that year.
You were the horse.
Oh, that's right.
Oh, Scott Sullivan says it's Jared Leto.
It might be. That might be Jared Leto on the far left.
Yeah,
that's too bad. That's right.
Everybody's favorite Joker, Jared Leto.
All right. Well, we have like 9 out of 11 people. We have a 9/11 here. 9 out of 11.
9/11. Never. Two times it's been brought up on this stream. Subscribe.
We're gonna get the whole thing demonetized.
Never forget. Actually, it's kind of the third time because you brought up the Mission Accomplished banner too.
Yeah, so keep those super chats coming. This whole show is going to get demonetized before I'm done with it.
Well, when you decided I should show clips from YouTube, I thought, oh, okay, so we won't be making any money on this stream.
It might. Have you already got the notification? Have I? I'm streaming this too. I should double check.
Do you get notifications in real time?
I don't know. I don't think so.
No. Okay. Come on, John. You've been off too long.
All right. Next clip. This one's recent. We don't have to watch the whole thing because everyone's already seen it, but I do want to give a shout out to Ryan Gosling and the I'm Just Ken performance. I have already rewatched this, no joke, six or seven times.
I'm not showing that one. That will get me.
He's great. He starts the whole number with his hat down in the crowd right behind Margot Robbie. And you can tell Margot is already losing it just in hysterics that Ryan's going. He's going full send, as the kids say, with the pink outfit, Marilyn Monroe inspired. And it's just such a fun. And then all the dancing guys pull away, and then Slash just whips out his guitar solo. It was like, oh shoot!
Oh yeah, that was out of nowhere. Slash is everywhere though. He's kind
that
of
was
this
great.
Majestic
I was literally
unicorn.
I literally did the DiCaprio from What's the Tarantino movie in the 70s? The Once Upon a Time. I literally did the that slash meme as soon as he showed up. I'm like, yeah. Hey, I know him.
He's everywhere. Great.
Loved it. Loved it. What do you have next?
Speaking of, I don't need to show any clips for my last two, actually, but this is just something that's been long overdue. Speaking of The Revenant, Leonardo DiCaprio finally wins a freaking Oscar in 2016 for that role after failing to do so 5 times prior.
Just like a lot of people have been nominated 0-5. Yeah. Ed Harris, Glenn Close, Annette Bening, Peter O'Toole, but for some reason, Leo's 0-5 felt more egregious. Like the movies he was missing were like, what in any other year? That's the strongest performance. But he was always up against like Daniel Day-Lewis in Lincoln. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, yeah, obviously. Okay. Or whatever year he was up, Gilbert Grape he was up against.
That was his first one. Yeah.
He was up against somebody else that put an even better performance. And it was like every year it was arguable or even agreeable that he was second best. And this, I was like, this award
felt kind of like the, it's your due. It's your time. Yeah. I don't feel like this was his movie for it. But Denzel Washington getting it for like Man on Fire or some random shit when he had so many amazing performances prior to that. It just felt a little, was that what Denzel won?
I think he won for Training Day.
Okay, Georgia. One of those. I knew it was one of the like, I'm tough, you know, on the streets kind of guy. Yeah, it just didn't feel right. But I'm glad it happened. It was the longest kind of ongoing joke that Leonardo DiCaprio would never win.
I'm going to really quickly, because I'm curious more than anything, my own edification here.
Yeah, please.
Let's skip ahead. Leonardo. So let's bump ahead to...
Is this a you have to say thing? It with...
You got to say it with an Italian accent. Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo DiCaprio. So he was... Am I on the right page? Academy Award for Best Actor. Was he not credited as Leonardo for Gilbert Grape?
I would imagine he was Grape Boy or Leo the Grape, maybe. I don't know. No, he should have been credited as it. Leonardo, do I need to do this, John?
I have the Wikipedia up for best Academy Award for Best Actor, and I know Gilbert Grape came out in the early 90s.
You know the Golden Globes, their website, you can actually, they have it all listed there every single year. You can
the Oscars probably do too, but I just default to looking to researching everything on Wikipedia because I'm a lazy millennial.
I'm gonna try the Oscars and see what shakes out.
Right, so he won for The Revenant. He was up against that year Bryan Cranston, Matt Damon, Michael Fassbender, and Eddie Redmayne. All good picks. The year he lost prior to that, he lost to Matthew McConaughey in Dallas Buyers Club. Right? Mm-hmm. Again, that's fair. McConaughey was really good in that. In 2006, he lost with his role in Blood Diamond to Forest Whitaker in The Last King of Scotland. I have not actually seen Last King of Scotland, but again, that felt like pretty good consensus that everyone loved it. In 2004, his role in The Aviator lost out to Jamie Foxx in Ray. And for some reason, I cannot find Gilbert Grape on this big table.
But... I see Gilbert Grape, 1993, but I don't see who he was up against.
In 1993, Tom Hanks won for Philadelphia.
That's the 65th Academy Awards. Here we go. I'm finding it right now. We're almost there.
65th, Al Pacino won for Son of a Woman.
Well, it's supporting role, right? Or is it?
Oh, Oh, that's why I don't have it. He was up for a supporting role.
I thought.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
Well, that would explain it then. That's why I couldn't find it on the Best Actor page. It was a supporting actor.
Supporting, yeah.
That makes sense. Leonardo lost What Eating Gilbert Grape to Tommy Lee Jones in The Fugitive. Thank you, Sine Fantanique, for doing what we couldn't with two keyboards.
Tommy's
five
great.
5 minutes gotta of your
it,
time.
Gotta give it to
Tommy. And again, that feels like, I know playing the mentally challenged seems like kind of a gimme to the Academy that's always... seems to get praise. You never go full R word, as they said in Tropic Thunder. But I honestly, Tommy Lee Jones in Fugitive is really, really good.
Yeah, he's great.
And I love that sometimes you can get an award for playing a regular guy. He's not a real person. It's not a biopic. He's not on any spectrum. He's not like a historical figure. He's a federal marshal, and that's it.
He's a damn good federal marshal.
Yeah, and I love Sam Gerard. I love when actors win for original characters. Did we get any of that this year? Who won this year? We had Cillian Murphy for a real person. Yeah. We had Divine won for The Holdovers, and that was a fake character.
Mm-hmm.
It still happens. It feels like a lot of the winners for best actor go to real people. And I think there was actually somebody on Reddit put together a thread, and in the last 20 years, something like 70% of all best actor and actress trophies went to people playing real historical figures, which is just, I don't know, it's just how it shakes out these days. I don't know why.
Well, it kind of shook out that way, and I have something like that on my list in the past, but we'll get there.
I think we went off on another tangent. Where are we at? My fifth favorite Oscar moment is a long one we don't have to sit through, but it is when Charlie Chaplin, at the ripe age of, I think, 72, was given an honorary Lifetime Achievement Award. And the standing ovation in, I believe, the Dolby Theater that year lasted for 12 minutes, according to reports. I think the video is edited. But when they gave Charlie Chaplin an award, you know, good 40 years after, maybe 30 years after his last, you know, big relevant movie, they stood and clapped for 12 minutes. And like the man is a legend. And watching him at that age in his twilight, because he only lived a few more years. If you scrub back a bit, like he goes through the speech basically on the verge of tears. Because this is the entire voting body of the Academy just applauding him for the first 3 or 4 minutes of this video, which I believe is edited. And it's just tremendous to see. Love this guy.
That's awesome. They just keep going all the way. Wow. This is the whole video is just clapping. Oh, here we go.
Thank you for the honor of inviting me here. And, oh, you're wonderful, sweet people. Thank you.
It was like a 12-second speech, but...
Yeah, it's got 5 minutes of clapping.
I just choked in my water a little bit, excuse me.
Yeah, that's okay. That's all right.
That happens. Live...
Let the tears come out.
Live theater here. Yeah, no, it looks like I'm crying, but I'm literally choking.
You're just moved. You're moved by it all.
I've actually seen the clip too many times to still be moved by it.
Sure.
But, the first time I watched it, and I just sat there in real time, kind of going over, you know, his life in film. And he actually did win one competitive Oscar for his film Limelight, which was released in 1954, but it never screened locally in Los Angeles County. And the Academy has a specific set of rules that you're only eligible for an Oscar if your movie screens within the TMZ, within the 30-mile zone of Los Angeles for 2 weeks in the year of eligibility. So it came out in 1954, but it never screened in LA until the 70s. So it was finally up for competitive Oscars 20 years later, and he won for Best Original Score. That's the only Oscar that Charlie Chaplin ever won in his career competitively, besides that honorary one, was for music he wrote that was 20 years stale. And it's like this guy like invented physical comedy. And he's one of my favorite filmmakers, and such a cool moment that before he died they managed to get him a trophy, because a lot of times they wait on some of these and it's like, yeah, let's give this guy an honorary award before he kicks the bucket, because he's definitely not going to be in any competitive categories again. And I worry that that's going to happen to Glenn Close, probably, because
she never won.
She's like 0-11. It's like, actually, Annette Bening's getting up there too. She lost again Sunday night and she's like 0-7. And Amy Adams is another one that's been nominated a bunch.
She's been nominated a lot,
but Amy Adams is young and I think she'll still have a chance. But whoever I mentioned first, Glenn Close. Yeah, Glenn's getting up there. I don't know if she still has a lot of Oscar-winning performances in her, so she'll get an honorary one for sure.
I would hope.
I would too. I like her.
You know, you want to talk about late to the game getting an award. How about post-death? Heath Ledger winning for Best Actor as the Joker in 2008, Dark Knight. I think that's maybe what they were hoping to do with Chadwick Boseman, but not happening. But Heath Ledger got that award and absolutely deserved it. I know people that don't like The Dark Knight, but they will 100% agree that
there's
Heath
the
Ledger,
door. Get out of here.
Hey, I know. It's not me. I love it. But there's people that don't like it, but they will say Heath Ledger, freaking showstopper. And I agree.
He's,
I mean,
he's great.
He's so good. Every scene he's in, he steals. And
I think the key to a really, really great performance is imbuing a little bit of that physicality into it, mm-hmm. which is a big reason why I loved Emma Stone in Poor Things.
Yeah.
Because there's a scene in that movie where she basically dances for the first time. And I'm not an actor. I don't pretend to know too much about the craft. But how do you, as a 35-year-old woman who is obviously very talented and able to dance, pretend like you've never moved your body like that before? You are pretending not to how to dance. And it's like, how do you portray that physicality in a way that makes sense to the viewer? Like, I'm moving, but I need to tell you and telegraph to you I'm moving in a way that I've never done before.
Right.
And Heath Ledger is doing a lot of that, like with the little fidgets and the twitches. And it's like, oh, this guy is a little unhinged. Like, you could watch that movie with the sound off and be like, this guy's a loose cannon. And I love that about his performance. And then the little flares and stuff he does on top of it with his voice affectations and the way he's making his voice go up and down. And it's like, oh, he is really creepy to me.
Well, you
and
don't
like
see
it,
him at all. You do not see Heath Ledger in that character. He is completely transformed in that movie. This is not the dude that was singing on bleachers and 10 Things I Hate About You or, you know.
Those movies are only like 8 years apart.
Right.
It's crazy. And I remember the discourse pretty well, as I'm sure you do too, when they were announced that Chris Nolan had rebooted Batman with Batman Begins. And then it was like, oh, in the next movie, in the big sequel, we are going to bring back, you know, the number one baddie, Joker himself. And playing him is teen heartthrob from that night. What was the name of that night movie?
I was going to say A Knight's Tale. Yeah.
A Knight's Tale. The big
heartthrob from A Knight's
Tale.
We will rock you.
Heath Ledger. And it was like, really? Everyone was like, this guy? Like, you're out of your mind, Warner Brothers. This is going to be a flop. Chris Nolan's lost it. You had a couple good movies with Memento and Prestige, but you're washed, buddy. Forget
it's over.
It. And then The Dark Knight comes out, and it's one of the first movies to ever make $1 billion. And I couldn't have been happier to watch all those people eat crow, because I was kind of like, yeah, let's see. Yeah, it could be fun. And remember when we had the same exact discourse for Jared Leto and we were actually all right?
I know. It, at some point, it felt like it was stunt casting, you know, directors, casting departments going, all right, it worked for Ledger. And it was definitely something where Nolan just kind of threw something at the wall. He clearly didn't have him in mind for any reason. So we'll just do it again. The stunt casts do not work unless that vision is there. And I don't think there was any vision for Suicide Squad. But maybe if we could ever get David Ayer cut, can we get that cut?
What did it say on Jared Leto? Somebody in the chat can remind me. What did it say on Jared Leto's forehead?
I think it was damaged.
Right? It was something stupid. It looked like a Hot Topic, like, stick-on. Like,
can
you
please have some respect for the Academy Award winning makeup? Because that's what it was. Academy Award winning makeup.
It didn't win for visuals. It was makeup? Okay.
It was makeup and costume. Okay. I believe. Okay. Yeah. The teardrop J under the eye.
It's too funny.
Have some respect, John. All right. Super chats. Nothing new. It doesn't look like so. We are on the last category.
That was a fun category. I liked watching some of those clips because
that was fun.
I feel like you don't even watch the telecast. I said you said you didn't watch it on Sunday night. But usually I'll watch the Oscars the night it happens, talk about it for a couple days, and then never look at it again. And I have found, especially this week, going back and rewatching old Oscars for movies I love. Like, I went back and I watched some of the acceptance speeches for, what did I see just the other day? I watched a lot of the stuff from the 1990s awards. And I was looking at some of the year that Unforgiven and Field of Dreams were up for some of these. I'm like, oh, I remember these. I love these films. And it's nice to go back to, like, movies you are very familiar with. And seeing the original acceptance speeches for when they first happened. And whereas you don't get that sort of perspective of hindsight when it happened 2 days ago.
Well, right. You know, anyway. I lied. We actually have two more categories. Why did we make so many categories, John?
I don't know. We can do. Let's just do it quick. We'll do it.
We'll do rapid fire.
I'll shut up.
Well, no, you don't do that. Don't censor yourself. Don't stifle yourself. We do have one super chat that came in out of a cannon. Perm, $10. Thank you, Perm, from the top rope. I honestly didn't realize it was Heath Ledger until halfway through the movie. When I realized it was him, I was amazed and had all new respect for him. And he is, of course, referring to A Knight's Tale. Yeah, he really transformed for A Knight's Tale. I was surprised it was Heath Ledger as well. Thank you, Perm. He's talking about Dark Knight. I can't let that joke slide.
Yep.
I can't let that joke go. I have to explain it. Those are the best jokes when you have to explain them. All right, indeed. John, we have next Worst Best Picture Winner.
Perhaps more accurately titled, The Biggest Best Picture Upset.
Wow, I don't know if that's better. It's different of a title.
Best upset or worst upset. And I think in each of these categories, let's name our nominee for what we think should have won instead. And I think that's pretty easy, actually.
It might be for, well, let me see. No, that's not easy. I got some old stuff on here, John.
Nah, it's easy. It's easy. John. If you can't do it, get out of here. Forget you call yourself it. A reviewer?
I really don't.
All right, so let's. I'll read them off, and then we can quickly talk about it. So, what's your first pick for biggest upset as a best picture? Last 50 years.
All right, so this goes back to the way back machine in 1979 with Deer Hunter, Robert De Niro, Christopher Walken.
Film?
No, it's not. I don't like this film. I think it's the most overrated shit I've watched. I saw it. Many years ago, obviously not in theaters, I wasn't born, or when I was a kid. I watched it when I was probably 30.
And okay, so that's old enough to appreciate it, at least.
I'm a grown-ass man. It felt like it was trying to do Godfather, but in war times. Long, long intro wedding stuff, and just boring, meandering. The only memorable scene in the whole film is the Russian roulette moment. When they're spinning the chamber of the gun. Otherwise, nothing happens in this movie. It's tedious.
I'm gonna look it up on Letterboxd real quick, because I definitely have the same feelings as you. There's a good middle portion, or like full hour at the beginning of that. That's not particularly great. I came around on it, and I liked what Michael Cimino was doing in the movie, especially the stuff in Vietnam and the Russian roulette stuff is tense and frightening, and relatable.
Yeah, it's like the right word. It's like 10 minutes of the movie.
But that's like super powerful stuff, and I was like glued to the TV for those moments. But yeah, there's like an hour of that where it's like, can we just get to the whatever? And that being said, in 1978, it was up against Coming Home, Heaven Can Wait, Midnight Express, and An Unmarried Woman. And I have actually only seen of those four, Heaven Can Wait. And I like Heaven Can Wait. I think Warren Beatty's in that movie. And I remember thinking it was pretty fun. It's a bit like, if you haven't seen it, what's the one with Jimmy Stewart in the bridge? It's a Wonderful Life, right? Where he dies and he kind of learns the value of his life.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I know. This is what my wife does. She monitors and then she yells at me if I miss a super chat. But I see all. I'm like freaking Eye of Sauron. All right, sorry to interrupt you, John.
No, that's all right.
Of utmost importance, I do this now and steamroll what we were just talking about. The Blind Mask had a super chat for $5. I would have got to you, but we're doing it now because I don't want to yell that again. He says, is it Ki Hugh Kwan?
K.
Hugh Kwan and Brendan Fraser's speeches are both beautiful recent moments for me. K. Hugh Kwan, obviously the Goonies. He was in Everything Everywhere All at Once. Yeah, it's so cool seeing him. Kind Temple of like of having this resurgence coming back into
don't
the
spotlight. Don't miss my boy Indiana. He was in Temple of Doom too.
Yes, of course. Short Round himself. He's great. He's great in everything. It's just cool that he's back.
It is very cool that he's back.
His speech was fantastic. I did see it. I don't think I ever saw Brendan Fraser's speech though.
That was really good too. He was clearly moved and very humble.
Was this the whale thing?
Last year. It was. They were both. They were all really good. Jamie Lee Curtis winning for Everything.
Yeah.
Also had a really nice speech because she's been around Hollywood since your dad, Tony Curtis, was winning awards, right? So she's to finally get the recognition at whatever age she is, like 68 or whatever.
Angela Bassett was just throwing a fit recently that she lost to Jamie Lee Curtis.
Oh, was she?
Yeah, she was mad that she didn't win for freaking
Black
stupid
Panther 2?
Wakanda Forever.
Wakanda Forever.
Which, what the fuck did she do in that movie? She was, I didn't see anything from that role. And
there was one good monologue that she had.
Yeah.
And it was good. And I'm glad that Marvel movies are getting some, you know, competitive recognition, but I don't think it deserved to win.
No.
For my first pick as worst Oscars upset, I have 1981's Chariots of Fire, which I've seen all 96 Best Picture winners. I ranked them on Letterboxd by my rating. Chariots of Fire is my least favorite of all of them. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's boring. It is slow.
I like this. Is that the scan ten 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 ten?
The music
when they're running on the beach and it's the race. I like that movie. It's been a million years since I've seen it, but I remember liking it when I was in.
Admittedly, I've only seen it once, and I'll always be the first to say this. I'll give any movie 2 tries to win me over. If I don't like it twice, then maybe it's not me, it's you. And I've only seen it once, and maybe I was in the wrong headspace for it. But I do not care for it. The fact is, it wasn't like I thought it was okay. I literally rated this the lowest of all 96. And you know what was also nominated that year in 1981?
What?
Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Ooh.
My second favorite movie ever. And that to me is like, here's my second favorite movie. Here's my least favorite Oscar winner. There's an imbalance
that's
needs correcting.
And to be fair, John, I saw it in school. It was a watch in middle school. So I probably would have liked literally anything they put on because I'm not doing homework.
Yeah. I watched Gandhi in high school. And I remember, this is really good. If I watched today, I'd be like, can we hurry up already?
Right.
But in school, I wanted it to be a long movie. Right? If it's 3.5 hours, that's like four. That's a whole week of class we get to
skip. That's a lot.
All right. What else you got?
All right. Now,
I'm not looking at the document. And
I want to clarify. I actually like this movie, but this is what we in the business would say mid. It's a very mid film. And that's The King's Speech. Came out in 2010. It won. And listen, on any other year, maybe it gets nominated. But this thing went up and won over Black Swan, Inception, 127 Hours, Social Network, and Toy Story 3. Are you out of your mind with this pick?
Yeah.
Come on.
This was the first year I did my big Oscar special on YouTube where I review all the nominees. This was also the second year they expanded to 10, which made it even more work for me. I liked when they used to do 5. It was easier. And of those 10, I've reviewed and rated and ranked all of them. King's Speech, I think, was like, it was, again, great film, but it's like third from the bottom in that group of 10. Winter's Bone, Kids Are All Right, True Grit, The Fighter, also, I think, better films.
Better, more memorable films, too. Who doesn't reference Inception or Black Swan or, you know, even 127 Hours? People make jokes about that.
Great film. Yeah,
it is a great film. And they were just so different. You know, they were completely different for the time.
Scott Sullivan with an excellent point. All the rational voters got split and all the people who were wrong voted for The King's Speech.
That's fair,
And this, and this
won
is exactly,
by default.
Right, and this is exactly what the ranked choice preferred ballot they do now prevents.
Sure.
So everyone was like, yeah, King's Speech was like my second favorite. And it won instead of what it should have been, which is not winning.
This was kind of, there's so many movies like The King's Speech where I kind of lump into the same bucket of, yeah, they're good period piece dramas and I kind of move on and don't really think about them again. What was that one? It was called The Imitation Game. Remember that from a few years
ago?
Yeah,
I do. Yeah. Vaguely.
Good movie. Feel like that's on the same level as King's Speech. Wins
an Oscar, they're the kind of films that they leave like a good taste in your mouth, but you forget about them almost like instantly.
Right.
It's like a really tasty wafer. It's like, oh, this tastes great, and I am still hungry. You know what I mean? Like it's
tasty wafer.
It's like the opposite. Like it's the opposite of fast food, right? Because fast food, you feel it. It's great going down, but it's like now I'm bloated and I hate myself.
Now I'm hurting.
Whereas The King's Speech is like, oh yeah, that was great.
Oh,
I'm sorry. What was this about? I don't remember.
Just little taste, morsels.
Yeah,
it's good.
Yeah. All right. Next pick for me, going back a bunch of years to 1985, when Out of Africa from Sydney Pollack won Best Picture. I have seen this. It is, again, okay. I think this is probably in my bottom 5 of the 96 Best Picture winners. I like Meryl Streep enough. I don't like these big, sluggish epics where it's like 3.5 hours in the Australian outback. And it's like, can we just, is there a point to this? Do these characters even like each other? Because 2 hours of the movie, they're just like, it's not great. It's very boring. It's very long.
I have not seen this movie.
That same year, it went up against The Color Purple, Kiss of the Spider-Woman, Prizzi's Honor and Witness. Admittedly, full disclosure, I have not seen any of those except Witness. I love Witness, one of Harrison Ford's best. But in 1985, there was another movie that was released that year that I think should have got more critical recognition. And it's Back to the Future again. I got to bring it back to where we started the show.
Bring it all comes circling.
Got to bring it back. I don't know that Back to the Future would have won or should have won, because it's like a populist comedy. It came out in July, and those are never the types of films that win Oscars.
I don't want to get too lost in the weeds, John, but there's been some gross talk lately from people I think that were completely against this 5 years ago that are thinking, hey, maybe now is a good time to redo Back to the Future for a new generation.
No.
I agree.
And as long as Bob and Bob are alive, it won't happen. So
I know, but there's not a lot of time left on that clock. And Disney can wait. Disney can wait. Mickey's like, only a little bit longer, motherfucker.
You better look out, Zemeckis. I think if you said that line about there's not a lot of time on the clock, but if you said it with a more center, there's not a lot of time left on your clock, Bob Gale.
Exactly.
And he's just like in some Malibu beach house writing another screenplay, like, oh.
I don't get why people are now having this perception when almost every remake that's come out has been either awful or just mediocre, but they never hit the level of the good.
If Ghostbusters Afterlife is like the best we can do for these Lego sequels, then leave Back to the Future alone.
Exactly. Exactly.
Granted, I have been fan casting in my head what that could look like if they were foolish enough to do it. Yeah. And obviously, the way you do it is Marty, and we can't do it because Michael's not physically able enough to act in a movie.
Tom Holland. Do not say
Tom Holland. No, not Tom. But if you were to do it, and if Michael was physically healthy enough to do it, he would be the Doc analog. He would be the crusty old man who's like, don't be screwing around my time machine. Yeah. And the kid would be his daughter, played by Zoe Dutch, the real-life daughter of Leia Thompson, because she is a great actress. I think she could do funny stuff well. But she's already, like, aged out of the role. She's, like, in 31 years old.
I did a bit on this where they have to do the complete pander and make it a sex swap where it's Maggie McFly and Doc is McCarthy is Doc.
No.
terrible.
No. I think it would legitimately be, and you would have to have done this like 10 years ago, but if you had Michael as the old scientist, he wouldn't be a son, but the old guy, and then his daughter, played by Zoe Dutch, doing the role reversal, person out of time. And I think it works because the movies have always been generational, and you go back to when your parents, and if you went back to the 80s and revisited some of the moments from those first three movies, but the 80s moments from those, like, say you go back in time and you revisit the parking lot scene, like, there could be some cool shit you could do there. Everyone's kind of aged out of it, and if you can't get the actual people, then don't bother. Like, without Michael J. Fox, the idea is dead on arrival.
Let's not animate him like we did in Indiana Jones 5.
Don't.
Speaking of car accidents, my number three worst Best Picture winner is Crash from 2004.
Yep.
And it's, again, not because I don't like this movie. I actually don't mind Crash. I thought it was fine-ish. I didn't think it was great. I just think this one was totally a product of there wasn't much better in 2004.
I disagree. I think...
Really?
Brokeback Mountain, I think, is a beautiful film.
Okay, you know what? I have yet to see Brokeback. I have heard it's good. Really good. It's on my list, but my list is very long.
I think for all non-homophobes, it's a brilliant film.
Yeah. For non,
if you struggle with your sexuality, you might have a different time with it. But
hey,
I know you don't, so you'll be great.
I was in theaters day one for that terrible new Coen brother movie, Drive Away Dolls, which
I think you said you hated it, right?
It was so bad.
Well, that's too bad.
So bad.
Brokeback Mountain.
The homophobia, of course.
Yeah, yeah. Brokeback Mountain. I haven't seen it since it came out, but legitimately a beautiful, excellent film and one of the best like modern romances of the last 20 years. And actually, I don't know why. And also, Good Night and Good Luck was another great,
John,
great film.
John, to clarify, I celebrate all walks of life, not bigoted or anything like that. And I'm going to clarify this because John, who was it? Sean Chandler told me that when I was going to MegaCon, he had a fan that said, "Oh, Adam's going to be there." I used to like him until he straight up admitted he was racist and sexist in a video. And Sean goes, "I think he was just joking." But yeah, it's amazing how people take like obvious sarcasm
I like to give my audience the benefit of the doubt, and I'm sure you do as well.
Yeah.
But I have found historically, time and again, over explaining has always been better. Err on the side of assume they don't get what you mean.
Sadly, yeah, that's kind of what you.
And it's like
do.
I hate to like neuter my own jokes with I'm joking, right?
It's a
because
joke.
That kind of takes the wind out of its sails. But more often than not, someone would be like, "I can't believe you didn't think black people could be legitimate actors, John." I'm like, "Jesus, I was obviously making a joke."
An animated punch card needs to come out. It's a joke. It's a joke.
I need, you know what I need? I need Fozzie Bear as a gift. Waka waka every time I make a. Because I've made some like really obvious jokes. And it's like, you guys really, when I'm like full tilt, like, you know, Confederate flag waving racist, you know that that's a gag, right? And like some people don't, and that's concerning. So I don't do that as much anymore. Sarcasm doesn't work on the internet unless you put the upside down emoji at the end of your comment. And even then, people need help. Crash, that is a great pick. Again, kind of an okay film, but I think Good Night and Good Luck, Brokeback Mountain are better. Oof. I haven't seen Capote or Munich. I've heard they're great too.
I didn't, yes. Man, okay. Good Night and Good Luck, that's the George Clooney movie director?
No, that's David Strathairn, and he plays Edward R. Murrow, the CBS newscaster from the 50s, I think.
What's the black and white George Clooney movie?
I don't know.
Isn't that Good Night and Good Luck?
I don't know if George... No, you are right. George Clooney directed it.
Yeah.
Is George Clooney in it?
No, he's not in it. He is in it.
He plays... Fred W. Friendly. I need to watch
maybe
this movie.
I maybe didn't make it to George Clooney because I hated that movie so much. I shut it off.
I don't remember him. I remember David Strathairn, but I don't remember George in that one.
I knew he directed it, and his new movie, Boys in the Boat, was a lot better.
That was pretty fun.
Yeah, I like that one. Just a kind of a standard, you know, feel-good movie, but sometimes it's nice to get
it was a good mystery movie selection.
Yeah. Did you go to the one yesterday, by the way?
I sure did, and I liked it.
I it was between the magical N-word and Arthur's King Arthur, whatever. I'm like, nope, I don't want to see either of them. I don't care.
It was Arthur the King.
It was Arthur the King, right? Yeah.
It was.
Yeah.
Did I close my? I think I closed my tab. Anyway, next pick. I think last pick of the night. Nope, we have another category. Maybe we'll skip that. It's getting late. We have the. Biggest Oscar upset, again, these are unranked, 1989's Driving Miss Daisy, which somehow won over Born on the 4th of July, Dead Poets Society, Field of Dreams, and My Left Foot.
But it has...
This is like a murderer's row of 80s cinema.
It's a quaint movie about a privileged white woman and her black driver, John. Come on.
It's so like this is Driving Miss Daisy won for the same reason that Green Book won in literally the same same movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's just let's race swap it. Okay, yep. It's just like we want the old white people of the Academy to feel good about their black friend.
That's right.
So let's give it to like Green Book's a fun movie. Driving Miss Daisy is pretty good. I like Morgan Freeman in that movie a lot. But Dead Poets Society, Field of Dreams, are you kidding me? Those are like all timers for me. Yeah. And Born on the 4th of July is really good, too. I don't get how this won.
Born on the 4th of July was great.
That's one of Tom Cruise's best roles.
Well, he's he's a character in it.
And they gave it to a movie with Jessica Tandy. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's go to, on that note, we have one more category.
Let's really speed through this one.
We're ending on a positive, but let's get these super chats out of the way.
Someone I hate this one from the Hulk. I hate this. I hate this idea from the Hulk.
What do we
well, got? You read. I'm going to eat.
I did perms, I think. Yeah, I did perms. We got Sabin Figaro? Figaro? $10 super chat. Thank you, Sabin. Frisbee, far out. And don't touch Back to the Future, please. Okay, I like it. I like it. And yes, I agree. Stay away from my Michael J. Fox. Hulk for $10, Back to the Future animated movie voiced by Awkwafina and Chris Pratt. Sending love. And John, you have a new subscriber. Great job, gentlemen.
Thank you, sir. No, as soon as I saw your comment, I'm like, no, no, God, this is like the worst. Awkwafina, I don't know what it is. I like her enough, but I just noticed, I just had this realization the other day. She's in a lot of movies as voice.
Yeah.
She did Migration.
Yep.
She just came out with a new one. I can't remember the name of.
Kung Fu Panda 4.
Kung Fu Panda, Migration. And before that, she was in...
Little Mermaid, live action.
Little Mermaid. As
she's a bird in both of those movies.
She's in a lot. And I'm like,
it's
in too many things. And she has such a distinctive voice
that it's kind of like... And it never changes. Right. It's the same... Yeah. It's Gilbert Gottfried, but... I don't know. And people, obviously, there was plenty of people that didn't like his voice. But he wasn't voicing everything like she is.
Yeah, it is such a particular, almost grating kind of quality to it that in small doses can be funny and it works. But like we've seen her in everything. She's in all these movies now.
I just truly don't get the appeal of this actor at all. I don't get it. And she's everywhere. She haunts me now, John.
All right, we're going to end the show with
Awkwafina
six... With six of our all-time favorite movies that have won the Best Picture. They've been doing it since Wings won in 1927. 96 years of winners. I think we only picked from the last 50 years. But what is your, I don't know. Again, we're going unranked. But what's one of your favorite Best Picture winners, Adam?
Silence of the Lambs.
This is a fantastic pick. Again, I do want to make it clear, I've deliberately not chosen the ones you picked because they would probably be on my list too. Silence of the Lambs, 10 out of 10, one of the best movies of the 90s. It's also one of the only Oscar winners to win all of the top five awards, picture, director, actor, actress, and screenplay. Only three movies have ever done that.
Incredible.
And I think that's the most recent. We haven't had anything in the last 30 something years.
I also kind of love this pick because it is about as close as you get to the thriller horror.
It's a legitimate horror movie,
right?
Or at least horror adjacent, and that's it's nice to see a movie that's not a dramatic biopic based on true events.
Poor Anthony Hopkins would be unable to live this role down for basically his entire career because it was so goddamn good.
But he lived it down in the way that he ended up doing. What Remains of the Day came out a couple years after this, and he was nominated for that.
Mean live it down like he can't.
Oh no, I know, I know.
I mean, people would be coming up to him on the streets until they still will until the day he dies. You know, quoting the movie. How many movies and shows have referenced just that scene of him putting on the face and say, "Hello, Clarice. It's good to see. It's nice to see
that's,
you."
That's
again.
Another. We didn't mention it in our favorite Oscar moments, but there's a bit. At the very beginning of, well, I guess it would have been the 1992 telecast when Silence of the Lambs was nominated, Billy Crystal begins the show as host being wheeled out on a gurney with the full mask on.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
It's a great bit where he doesn't say anything. The audience just erupts with laughter and applause. And he goes right up to Hopkins in the second row or whatever. And he's like, "I was thinking of having the Academy over for dinner. Would you like to join me?" And it's a great bit. I love Billy Crystal. The movie is so
good. It's such a cool premise of having this fish out of water FBI, female who's so small next to all
way
these
out of her
men,
depth.
Way out of her league, and she's going to this brilliant psychotic killer to figure out what's going on with a different killer, unrelated. It's just brilliant all around. I love how
and
he
they
psychologically
kind of turn
her.
That into a TV show a few times.
Yep.
The show Blacklist with James Spader is kind of that same. We need to go to a criminal to catch the criminals. Sinfonique mentioned in the comments here. Thank you for doing my research for me. It Happened One Night from 1934 and Network from, I believe, 1976 were the other two films to win those top five. Okay. Picture, director, actor, actress, and screenplay.
Right.
And they're all three of those movies are like perennial all-timers that absolutely love. One of my favorite Best Picture winners, and I think of all this 96, this is the one I have ranked highest. Jim Cameron's Titanic. And it's brilliant. I used to be ashamed. I'm ashamed to say that I was ashamed to say that, like, I didn't know that I could say that I loved this movie, because for a while it was popular to kind of rag on Titanic.
Yeah.
Especially men of a certain age. When you were like 18 and a guy, it wasn't popular to like Titanic.
Yeah,
it was like
a
girls'
movie. We're so immature. Remember seeing it in theaters and really giggling when people were falling off and hitting those propeller blades and
objectively funny moment there. And I sometimes, depending on my mood, I'll either laugh or I'll wince. And but yeah, Titanic, I watched it again for the 25th anniversary re-release just a couple like a year ago last February. And it's a masterpiece. I absolutely adore this film.
97, man. That was, do you remember? I'm a little older than you, but I remember just how insane people were for this movie. Moms were going to this thing 15, 20 times.
My sister went 3 or 4. My wife went 5 times. I went 2 or 3 times myself.
It was absolutely insane. I think I went to it twice, and I don't remember even loving it as a high schooler. I've watched it since, and I do enjoy it still. I wish Cameron would maybe not do Avatar movies anymore, but I guess that's where we're at with him now. So
yep. Whatever. All right, you need to talk about your next pick, because I think this is one that any guy over 30 will take a bullet for this film. This is one of the all-time best.
And this is another one of those rare exceptions at the Academy Awards when a movie that the mainstream all gathers around and rallies and says, yes, Lord of the Rings, Return of the King, 2003 deserves to win the Oscar. What a freaking movie. Again, it truly is a masterpiece of a trilogy. And I get the hang-ups. I get people not liking the New Zealand countryside walking tour.
Actually, I don't know, man. I mean, I can get away if the pacing isn't quite your speed, because it's such a long experience. But like, if you are not moved to tears by the end of this, you know, 9-hour epic, I don't know if you have a heart in your body. Because when Viggo says to the hobbitses, "You bow to no one," I weep every time. It is a brilliant film. More accurately, it's a brilliant trilogy. It really is. Return of the King was sort of the capstone of that entire 3-year
saga. I remember being so in theaters opening night, back when movies were fun and you would go at a midnight showing. Do you remember those, John? You go to a midnight showing.
I saw Revenge of the Sith. I had to drive into the city and go to a midnight show. I had to like skip work or class the next day. And
you stand in line for 6 hours to get a good seat.
And now the midnight screening start at, I think, 3 p.m.
On a Thursday. Yeah. I saw Kung Fu Panda at that time. Really, really magical. It was me and one guy snoring in the corner.
It's kind of wild that we include Thursday, like, matinee grosses in the Friday opening day total. It is weird, right? That we count that as 2 days.
I feel like they did this just to artificially pump those early numbers.
Oh, 1,000%.
Yeah, yeah.
But it seems really disingenuous that that's how we count box office totals.
1,000%.
Anyway, Return of the King, one of the best movies of the decade. Yeah,
Return
of the
King, I was in the theaters and people were chanting Rudy when Samwise threw him on his shoulder, "I'll carry you," and he goes up that fucking Mount Doom. I was, oh man, it was so good. Rudy. Yeah, amazing time. Amazing film.
I love it. 10 out of 10. That's one of, I was going to say, if I had to rank my favorites, my lifetime favorites, and I have ranked them, I don't have to. I've already done it. I just need to click on it. Return of the King is number 11 for me.
Nice.
Number 11, all time. And my number 10 is the Best Picture winner from 1976, which we've already talked about, Rocky. I love a good underdog story. Any movie where someone says to someone else, "You can't do this," and then that other character is like, "Watch me." That just lights me up every time. I love Rocky. That montage moves me. motivates me more than anything. It's one of the best films. Top 10 all-time favorite for me.
And it would spring a franchise that would continue to exist today.
We've got 10 of them now, right? Are we going to get a Creed 4? Will that Rocky X, let's do it.
Oh my God.
Rocky X.
Rocky X Creed. They bring him back. They bring back the Italian stallion.
That's how they should do it. Rocky X as the Roman numeral and then Creed. Rocky
X. Because that's get me back in the ring.
That's en vogue now because they did the Godzilla Kong is putting the X in there. It's like a
Saw X, Fast X. It's the thing.
Yeah, so
it's
the
thing. It's really dumb.
Stupid. All right, you got one more pick for best picture, favorite best picture
winner. Well, we just brought up a lot of these actors from Everything Everywhere All at Once 2022.
Hear you like this one because I don't think we've talked about it. And this movie was divisive. Some people hated it. My dad didn't really get into it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I get that. My dad's, 30 years our senior. But I'm glad you talked to me about it. Why do you love it?
So I went to it with my stepbrother. One of the last movies I saw in Minnesota, actually, before moving. And it had been a long time. And you can kind of feel it in your bones when you go to a movie and everything is firing for you. Like, your senses are all alive. When this movie fired up, I was just alive. I thought, okay, we got a damn movie here. And I turned over to my buddy, my brother-in-law, or stepbrother, whatever the fuck, it doesn't matter. I turned over to him 20 minutes into it. I go, are you getting it? Are you seeing this movie? And he was on board too. And
that's great. It's always really awkward so when that's not the case.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't remember the film, but recently my wife and I were watching a movie and I was really vibing with it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, this is great. And she's like, oh, and I was like, oh,
pardon.
That's always the worst. We're like, she's not into it at all. And I am. And then it's like, oh, all right. Well,
yeah. Lindsay actually didn't care for Everything Everywhere All at Once either. I showed it to my kids and her. Granted, it was the worst kind of experience they could have had. We watched it on the TV before it was out. This was back when I was doing freelance for Screen Rant. So I had access to their early videos, and this was like a shitty low quality 720p rip onto a TV. It was dumb of me, but she didn't like it. Kids liked it. I'd love to watch it again with them though, with the crisp 4K high-res viewing.
I can definitely see why certain people wouldn't. It operates on a very peculiar wavelength, and if you're not like tuned into that, it's gonna just smoke past you with a mile a minute stuff that it's building. And I was on from the very jump and I was like, I love where this is going.
Well,
and it's just taking some big swings and some big chances.
It's so we'll wrap it all up too. You know, people don't like quirky sometimes. It can definitely be hit and miss for people. And, rocks with googly eyes having a speech bubble conversation, not necessarily going to work for some, but it worked like gangbusters for me. All right, John, are you done? Am I done? You got one more.
We got one more. We'll wrap it all up with what is arguably, and I could make a very good argument with math and numbers to prove my point, the best movie ever. I don't think so. It's not my personal favorite. But The Godfather Part 2 has received more accolades and more praise and critical acclaim over the last 50 years since its release than I think any other movie ever made. It's the top or near the top of every list, right there with Godfather Part 1.
It's a fantastic
and
movie.
This is one of those years, one of the only times a sequel is won besides Return of the King. And so obviously well-deserved. It is a brilliant film that has influenced anything decent. and so many bad movies too. It's sort of been a perennial favorite from day one. And we even got Al Pacino himself on the Oscar stage just two nights ago in memoriam or in whatever you want to call it, in anniversary of The Godfather. That was Jimmy Kimmel announced him as celebration of Godfather 2's anniversary. Here's Al Pacino. And it's like, yeah, we're still celebrating this movie 50 years later. And for very good reason. It is one of the greats.
I like it more than the first part, actually. I don't know if you're in the
I like it better than part one. I have a tendency to like part twos a lot more than part ones just because they have the ending. They finish the story. And I like endings more than I like setups. But they really are two sides of the same kind of coin. Mm-hmm. And it is, brilliant. I need to go back. It's been a long time since I've watched that trilogy. And I heard recently that Francis Ford Coppola re-edited Godfather 3 and did like a director's cut that like included some things and rechanged the order. And I've heard it's better than the theatrical version of Godfather 3. I'm anxious to check that out.
To this day, watched Godfather Part 3. Because
I've never watched it.
Never watched it. I heard it's horrible. And I just have
it's not. It really isn't.
I own the movie. I bought the trilogy. I watched the first two right away. And then I like had it in my hands. And I kept thinking, like, I don't want to ruin this ride. But maybe I should jump on and make up my own mind, huh?
I would definitely encourage you to watch it, especially if you can get your hands on the new director's cut. I think it's called The Godfather Saga, not Godfather Part 3 or Godfather Coda. Because they treat it more like an epilogue to the first two parts, not as Act 3, but more as an epilogue to the first two.
And Duvall's in the third one, right?
Who is it?
Robert Duvall?
No, he passed on it for some reason.
Yeah, you know why? Do you know why?
Is it a joke? Is your answer
no,
a joke?
No, it's not a joke. It's because he wanted the same amount of money as Pacino.
Oh yeah, that's not gonna fly.
The original
Duvall's great.
The original script was about his character. It was gonna center around him. And he had more lines and scene time than the other guys, so he said I should be compensated just
that's
much.
Actually that's fair.
I agree. I don't disagree with it. And Duvall is a phenomenal actor.
Bobby Duvall is a fantastic actor, and I kind of feel like shut up and pay the guy. But
and so
they had to obviously dramatically rework that script.
They reworked it all because
I've said this before probably, but Godfather 3 is obviously far and away the worst of that trilogy. And I don't even know if it's a good Godfather movie, but it is a great movie. Yeah. And I think when you compare it with other movies that came out in 1990, it's exceptional. It is a great film. But when you compare it to Godfather 1 and Godfather 2, widely hailed as some of the top five. If you go to IMDb, I think they're both in the top 10. And then if that's what you're directly comparing it to, yeah, it's never going to be favorable. And you're always going to be like, yeah. Okay, it's not good. But yeah, so I would definitely recommend it.
I guess what you're saying is it's the Despicable Me 3 of the Despicable Me franchise. Pretty much the same thing, right?
I'm not familiar enough with Despicable Me to track that analogy, but I'll say yes.
Godfather, Despicable Me, pretty much, you know, the same amount of cachet and celebratory fan bases.
Daniel Foss says, let's get Chris Pratt in the Godfather remake. You are banned from the channel.
God.
Get him out of here.
Get Awkwafina, bring her in. Yeah. All right, let's do our final round of super chats. So bring them in now if you have them. If you're cooking,
we got a big boy here.
This is Logan.
This is the atomic bomb here from Logan.
Logan Wolf, shot out of a fucking cannon with a
the Enola Gay dropped the big one at the end.
51-11 missed another live stream. He says kind of sadly, I think, but he's paying for it. He's paying for it, and I appreciate it. Logan Wolf likes to come in kind of out of nowhere, out of the shadows, and give some of these awesome super chats. So thank you, Logan. We got one more from him for $8. It's always so random. $8.14. Goodfellas, for me, over Godfather 2, but I understand the love. Goodfellas is a great movie. I'm also a big fan of Casino. I like me some Pesci.
I celebrate the entire Scorsese catalog.
Well, yeah, I mean, come on.
Especially Hugo, which I think is very underrated.
Hugo? Is that that's not the animated one, is it?
No, it's 3D. It was in the train station, and it's sort of the backdoor biopic for George Clooney.
3D animated, come on.
It's live action, though.
It is live action. Okay.
With Asa Butterfield and Chloe Grace Moretz, Sacha Baron Cohen.
Yeah.
That came out in 2010. I loved it. It's like a love letter to cinema, specifically Marty's love letter to Georges Méliès, the brilliant French filmmaker from the turn of the century.
I get that.
If you haven't
movie.
Seen it or you haven't seen it in a while, check out Hugo. It's one of Marty's like most different movies, and it's so joyous and fun and celebratory. I love it.
I should check it out. I get that movie confused because I've only seen the cover of Hugo and it looks animated because of the poster.
Yeah, yeah. And Ben Kingsley, what I totally forgot to mention. He plays George Millet.
I get that confused with, I think, a Steven Spielberg movie that's animated.
Oh, Tintin?
Tintin. Yeah.
Yeah, came out around the same time.
Yeah.
I don't think they're related at all. I don't think there's anything similar.
No, nothing. Just for some reason.
And if you haven't yet explored the filmography or the works of Georges Méliès, I would recommend you go do a dive on YouTube. All of his movies are under 20 minutes long, and they're also like 120 years old, so they're pretty quick. But yeah, a trip to the moon, whatever that's one called, where they go underwater. He did some stuff with celluloid 30 years before anyone else figured out even what to do with it. Like 20 years before Chaplin, he was making stuff happen. Wow. Fantastic filmmaker. It's the kind of thing, as a young kid learning how to edit, watching some of his stuff in class in high school, I was like, this was done in 1903. I was blown away. Still good today.
But John, who if not me is going to waste their life away watching Criterion masterpieces like Adam Sandler's new Spaceman on Netflix or John Cena's new film Ricky Stenicki on Amazon Prime and reviewing them because I love my life. I don't know.
How was Ricky Stenicki? I actually was thinking about checking that out.
Not good.
Okay.
Not good.
All right. So I will put it on tonight.
Yeah,
put it on straight away.
Put it on. It's filmed very weird. It feels like one of those COVID movies where a lot of the backgrounds are maybe not real sets.
I have a buddy of mine that calls them Red Notices. So named for the eponymous Netflix film from a couple years
ago.
With Dwayne Johnson, Ryan Reynolds, and Gal Gadot.
Where
it's a movie that seems written by AI, filmed entirely on green screen, and just pumped out to appeal to as many quadrants of demos as you can. Let's get the girls, let's get the guys, the old women. Like, let's appeal to everyone.
This has every walk of life in it as well. It's I think it's directed by a Farley brother, but not both.
That's unfortunate.
This is the thing that's happening now. Wachowski off on her own making a terrible movie. Farley, Cohen, they're all ruining the relationships. I don't like it, John. But
what I did like was this podcast, this live stream. Thank you, Adam.
This was nice. This was good.
This has been fun. Let's do it again soon.
Where can, do we got anything to promote here? Anything?
Me? Absolutely. I'm actually doing YouTube again. So for the majority of you watching on Adam's channel, you can click my channel name in the title of the video. It says @Jog. Just click that. You can come over to my channel. I just came back from a 5-year break.
Wow.
I decided to have kids and get a real job. And I'm like, I don't really need this anymore. And then I got a little bit of an itch and I wanted to scratch it. And so I'm back reviewing movies on YouTube. Probably going to do some other content too. I don't only review movies, but I'm restarting there. And I just reviewed all 5 Dune movies, including the documentary about the one that wasn't. And by the end of the month, I'm also going to be reviewing and ranking all 10 Best Picture nominees from this past year. I'm a couple weeks late on that, but quality takes time. And if you check out my content, I think you'll agree it is perhaps overproduced. No one else in this space bothers to do half of the work I do, but I like spending 30 hours to make $10 in ad revenue. That's my job. That's the goal.
That's the dream, John.
Yeah, that is the dream. So anyway, if you like well-produced, articulate film reviews, come head over to Jogwheel.
Well, good news. Someone does. Logan Wolf for $10 says, okay, but John has a new follower.
Appreciate that. Thank you, sir.
There you go. And since this is streaming on John's channel too, feel free to come my way if you want. Adam does movies. I don't do the quality John does. We're just churning and burning over here.
You have more of a volume, and I also appreciate to advocate for you. I have been a fan and been a watcher of your content for I think as long as we've known each other, 11 years now.
It's been a long time.
And during my 5-year break, I would watch a lot of your content, a lot of your reviews. And so often I wished YouTube had like the equivalent of a retweet because I want to be like, endorse. This is what I think too. Just watch Adam's video. It's easier than me doing it.
Sure.
And so often I was like, I don't have time to make a video. I don't have time to edit. But Adam did. And everything he said, I agree with. So just watch his.
Adam's doing it. I'm like the Netflix of YouTube channels.
Yeah.
Who watched fucking Spaceman? Oh, Adam did. Okay, what'd he say? Yeah, no. I'm reviewing movies all the time. I roast them on occasion, and those ones actually do take a fair amount of work, as John knows, scripting it out, preparing the jokes, editing all the clips. It's a lot of work. So any support you can give is great. Again, I'm pushing Patreon. Patreon's a big thing for me this year. Patreon.com/AdamDoesMovies. There's vlogs at the $10 tier and higher. You get more if you give more. Because it's kind of, you know, it's a relationship like that.
I love what you're doing with the Mithril memberships, where you let people subscribe for 3 months, and then after you get enough of their money, you will do literally anything they ask in terms of
movie review. No, I've changed that now too, John, because that got torturous. I mean, torturous, the shit.
Well, then maybe I'll adopt it, because seems like a nice way to make good money is...
Tread lightly.
I will watch any... You want me to watch Sallow, 120 Days of Sodom? I'll put it on again. I'll do it if you
tread lightly. Now what they get is, if you're a Mithril for a few months, there's a roast list. There's a catalog on Letterboxd of some of the worst of the worst movies, but popular, you know, so it doesn't completely kill me when I put out a video.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so they can pick from that, and that's a fun time. That's where Matrix 4 just came from, actually.
I will say a very big advantage you have over what I do and the style I have is I'm usually very serious and very and literally buttoned up. And you have a lot more fun, and you're very loosey and very animated. And I'm not good at that, so I don't even try. I'm like, I could make really jokey, but I'm not as good at that. So, and I love that you're in this space doing that style, because I think for my money, you're better than anybody else at that, like, really fun, casual style review. That nobody else, I think, there's a lot of reviewers in this space, but you're one of my favorites. So
I appreciate that, man. Well, I've been saying it for years to you. It's good to have you back. So I'm glad you came in and you classed this place up a little bit, because it's kind of gone to shit with a lot of the new critics out there. We gotta clean up the pool a little bit.
I noticed that like Tom Scott, Matt Pat, they were like, I'm retired. And then Chris Stuckman was like, I'm effectively retired. So I got to put my foot back in YouTube, because like everyone else is leaving. There's a vacuum. And your boy JP is coming back to, I don't know, clean up crumbs for, you know, 5,000
What we're looking for here is the Awkwafina of YouTube movie critics. If you could be that voice for us, that's what we need.
Yes.
And on that note, John, always a pleasure. We'll have you on again sometime.
Sounds good.
Guys, subscribe to John. Subscribe to Movie Night, Jogwheel, all that good stuff. He's got tons of shit. Tons of stuff.
There's too many.
All right, guys. Thanks again for the support. Let me make sure nothing was lost. I don't think so. Lindsay hasn't yelled at me. So we will end there. Have a great night. We'll see you next Tuesday live. But I got a lot of videos in between because, again, it's just churn and burn over here.